Hello and welcome to The Wood Village Is Always Greener, a show where four friends have chill discussions about Diddy Kong Racing to distract themselves from the fact there is still no true sequel to Diddy Kong Racing. I'm Cyberlink.
I'm Game Buddy.
I'm Falero.
And I'm Rock the Jake.
And we are finally using our Diddy Kong Racing podcast to talk about Diddy Kong Racing. I know, it's surprising that it took us this long.
It needs a lot of build up for it.
I'm just going to come out with it here. I think it's a better game than Mario Kart 64. Fight me.
I
won't.
I have so many. You know, they say your favorite Mario Kart is the one you first played and grew up with. So I don't think I have a dog in this fight because I grew up with both of these.
I'm waiting for somebody to fight me. I'm looking to fight.
I don't think I can.
I'll fight you. My favorite Mario Kart is Crash Team Racing. Fight me.
Oh, we're going to talk about Crash Team Racing.
Just don't hit me too hard. I'm fragile.
I'll fight you that the kart balancing and characters are better on Mario Kart 64, but most everything else is better in Diddy Kong Racing.
Chris, are you going to fight me on Diddy Kong being better than Mario Kart?
Not really in this case. I think it's just it's just generally a better package, I think, than Mario Kart. Like, Mario Kart 64 was kind of a step back for Mario Kart. It's okay. But after Mario Kart on the SNES, man, I don't know. It was trying a lot of things, and I feel like Rareware looked at that and were like, okay, cool, we can make it better. And I think they did.
Okay, counterpoint, though. I'm a Wario. I'm a gonna win.
Yeah. you make a convincing argument. But yeah, no, like, Diddy Kong Racing is one of those games that is just such an intrinsic part of my childhood. So, you know, the fact that we get to do a deep dive on it today is just has me very, very excited. I'm curious what everybody's history with the game is. So,
We were chatting right before we recorded. I can't actually remember when I got this game. I know I owned it, and I played it a lot. I distinctly remember playing this and Banjo-Kazooie possibly concurrently, because I remember going back to Diddy Kong Racing and being like, oh, that's Banjo, the guy in that game I like now. And never playing as him in Diddy Kong Racing because he's not very good. But I love this game. I never beat it as a child. It's pretty tough. Like, once you get to those silver coin challenges. So as much as I loved the game and how it played and the vehicles and the world, my last memories of Diddy Kong Racing were just switching to the plane and flying around the hub world, looking for any other secrets instead of actually playing the game because I couldn't.
My history is very quick. I did not play this as a child. Played this as an adult, very briefly with a friend when we were trying to find a two-player game to play, and then much more extensively in preparation for this. So my history is like a little pamphlet.
Oh, so you don't quite have the nostalgia that we do.
I don't.
Perfect.
Yeah, well, that isn't that Jake, you know, the starry-eyed wonder child discovering things for the first time.
That's
well,
me.
Not the first time in this case, but close to it.
Basically.
So I played this when I was not a kid. I'm not a kid when the N64 was out. young teen. But this is something I played on the N64. It was my first experience of various characters that showed up in it, and when they got their own games, I was like, wow, it's Banjo from The Thing. I never really played as him either, but I like that he was there. yeah. I mean, he's all right for a heavy character, but I don't really play those. But yeah, this is one of those ones which I played when I was younger and have very strong, fond memories of just being like, well, it's like Mario Kart, but like if it were Mario 64. And so I like that idea. I do like this a lot. It's not quite aged as well as I thought it would have. But I still think there's a lot of charm in this game.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. Like, I definitely remember getting it as a birthday gift, like, the year after the Christmas where we got my N64. And, you know, I spent a lot of time just kind of, you know, playing around the tracks and everything. I don't think I ever unlocked, you know, the final world and the final character until years and years and years later. When I was like, okay, I'm finally going to sit down and actually do this. That would have been like maybe 2004, 2005 But yeah, no, like this game was always like a go-to when me and my siblings wanted to play multiplayer or when we had friends over or anything else. Like just a lot of really good memories there.
Yeah, I don't think I ever beat it myself, but we had like a family friend who was also playing at the same time who I went over to the house of, and well, they got to Whiz Pig at the very end, so they must have done all that stuff which I had to almost did this time around. So man, that's actually wild to think about. Someone did that with native hardware. Well, I'm sure those people exist.
Hello.
I do remember getting a stack of game magazines from a cousin of mine. I think it was EGM, Electronic Gaming Monthly, and they would have like little mini strategy guides that would try and boil down like an entire game's walkthrough to like 3 or 4 pages, so not a lot of screenshots. But I know there was one for Diddy Kong Racing that talked about the unlockables and like the final area and just reading and poring over that and then having this horrific sense of ennui because I was like, I'm not good enough to get there. So as much as I love this game, when I really think about it, there is some bittersweet like actual nostalgia, like a pain of longing because I remember that feeling as a child.
Yeah, I definitely know that feeling because I was in a similar boat where it's like every time I went over to a friend's house and it's like, oh, they have the Future Funland tracks. I'm like, I'm never going to get those. Oh. And then I eventually did. And then I felt better about myself. Mm-hmm. But that's here nor there.
Thanks, video games.
It is interesting to see how the game kind of came together, though. Like, as it happens, the story of Diddy Kong Racing starts with a little game called Killer Instinct 2, where basically as soon as the arcade version of that was finished up, they split the team in half. One went to work on KI Gold, the N64 port, and then the other half of the team went to start work on a new game. And that ended up basically taking form as a racing game that was basically like super inspired by Disney World, which is why, like, you know, they got the idea of like having the open space to explore with like the little sub areas, like a theme park. So that's kind of where that came from. And
interesting.
Yeah, it was originally, I think, called Wild Cartoon Kingdom, but then they changed it to Pro AM 64 and as like a spiritual sequel to RC Pro AM on NES, which is a hard ass game, like no joking.
Yeah, one of those in the still pretty cool Rare collection, right?
Yeah, and Rare Replay.
Yes, Rare Replay.
Like, I played those games for the first time in Rare Replay, and woof, those do not mess around.
I know. I feel like you got a little taste of the of Rare's classic stuff in Donkey Kong 64 and having to get really good at the, what is it? What is the astronaut
jetpack
game? Yes, Jetpack. Man, I remember that was another Rare game where I hit a roadblock where, if I remember correctly as a child, it wasn't Jetpack. It was, I literally couldn't beat the original Donkey Kong to get that damn coin.
Oh, man.
And now looking back, I'm like, oh, so gamer embarrassed. But hey, I 102% completed that game on the Wii U, so I never have to do it again.
Yep.
I had a lot of free time and did it on actual hardware.
Yeah. How do you beat Beaver Bother? You don't.
Barely.
You cheat. You cheat somehow.
I remember fighting K. Rool, so I must have made my way through those things. But man, that game.
It's, yeah, man. It's
a lot.
Yeah. Literally.
It's basically another Banjo game, but maybe it's a little bloated. And speaking of Banjo games, the whole reason that this game, you know, became Diddy Kong Racing is because Banjo-Kazooie was not going to be ready for Christmas that year. They needed more time to, you know, ready it up. So they're like, oh, shoot, we need some sort of like, you know, big mascot game we can market for the holidays. What do we got? What's almost ready? And, you know, Pro-AM 64 is over here. Is like, oh, you know, we can work with this, but we need to make sure this is going to sell. So let's take this little tiger kid that's the protagonist, shove him out for Diddy Kong, stick some other rare characters in there to like tease stuff we're working on. Bam, sell it.
Fund it.
Fund it.
And the rest, as they say, is history.
The Rareware just like throwing old ideas together and mixing them until they get something that actually works. And it's just like a tradition with them. And I don't know how they manage to make such good games, even with all these limitations and having to throw stuff together at the wall at the last minute.
Some would argue that's maybe the reason why, but, you know, that's neither here nor there.
Well, they're a rare breed, that's for sure.
I realize that maybe we're spoiled on racing rosters from more modern games where it's like Mario Kart 8 has too many characters. Please remove some of them. I don't know. I like most of the characters in DKR. I think they're pretty good. Like, you know, obviously Diddy, who was for my money the coolest, like the epitome of cool back in 1997.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, look at his Nintendo hat, man.
Exactly.
That's a cool guy.
The only way you could make him cooler is if you gave him his shades from DKC2.
I used to love Diddy Kong. I thought he was the coolest dude because of this game. And like that would carry forward into like other Donkey Kong things. And I don't know why, except he was just a funny little guy.
I've always appreciated Diddy from just like a gameplay standpoint, because like when my sister and I would play Donkey Kong Country 1 and 2 just mm-hmm. a ton as a kid, you know, I would always be first player, so I would always be Donkey and she'd always be Diddy. But then when we went to DK2, I got to be Diddy, she was Dixie. And I think it says something that like even all these years later, DK2 is the more fondly regarded one because of how well both characters play, but especially how well Diddy plays. And, you know, he's also fun in Donkey Kong 64 with his jetpack and pistols. And in this game, you know, like he is the medium character. He's the one that at least I started with. So,
mm-hmm.
I mean, he's the Mario, I guess.
Yeah,
he is the Mario.
He's the, you're all around. But like you said, he was not always the star.
Nope. Back in Pro-Am 64, the hero was Timber the Tiger, who I would argue is still, you know, in the game's plot, still feels like he is the protagonist that just invites Diddy to come along.
But yes, the very little plot in the game's manual. Correct me if I'm wrong, but doesn't Timber write Diddy a letter, literally like, "Hey, guy from other game, come help us."
Come help us sell this game.
Yeah. My understanding is that the Kongs and Timber's parents are like family friends. Mm. So they apparently just like hang out sometimes. But the whole plot is like hinges on Timber's family goes out of town, leaves him in charge. And of course, the one time he's left to watch the homestead, Whizpig shows up. He's like, "Ah, I'm taking over." He's like, "Oh, dear."
Whizpig, this giant magical wizard pig pervert from outer space. I mean, just terrorizing all of these furry children.
I mean, that's kind of what it is. It. He just saw like, oh, they've left it with the actual child. Great. I can just jump right in. Because if you listen to Timber, he's got this adorable little kid voice.
Oh, he does.
Yep.
Now I distinctly remember, like, my mother loved Timber because he was a cute little tiger, and she'd always loved, you know, little kitties and stuff like that. So I am remembering, yeah, Timber is like, hey, he's got a hat, too. He's a co-protagonist.
I believe Timber's voice was actually provided by, like, one of the sons of the Stamper Brothers.
Oh, that's pretty cute.
Cool.
Yeah, if you really listen, there are a lot of like, it sounds like authentic child voices for some of these characters.
Well, definitely the case for Timber, and he literally says "rawr." That's so great.
I know.
And then we have the one female playable character in the original roster, Pepsi, who was my go-to playing adventure mode back in the day before I unlocked the broken one.
Yeah. Like,
she has like, easily like the highest acceleration of the whole base roster. So it's like if you, you know, spin out or whatever, it's you can get back on the road pretty quickly when you're playing as Pepsi.
Not a high speed, so be careful, but she gets up there. Probably, I guess, the equivalent of like a Toad or a Yoshi.
So, yeah, somewhere in that range.
If we're talking Mario Kart 64 language.
Yeah. The thing I like about Pepsi is whenever you overtake her, she goes, oh, always makes me laugh for some reason. Mm-hmm.
Pepsi's also one of those interesting ones that has a lot of like backstory to how the design was created. Because apparently she originally started out as a kangaroo named Roo.
Oh.
I believe Kevin Bayless showed some like concept art of her from a while ago. You can still find a little bit of data.
Oh,
wow. Yeah.
That's cool.
Oh, that's cute.
Apparently the reason that they decided to change her was because they thought that they might want the characters to be able to run around outside of their vehicles. So it's like, well, no, we should probably have a character that should run and be instead of just, you know, having bespoke hop animations.
I was about to say,
yeah,
save yourself some work there, guys.
Yeah.
Instead, they made a not Minnie Mouse.
Yeah. So the next thing they did was try to work in a character called Astro Mouse from another canceled Rare.
Oh, I see.
Whoa.
But,
That's if you're British, that's a bad.
Yeah, I was going to say he's flipping the V's.
Yeah. That's funny.
Yeah, but apparently there were some collision issues with the sides of his suit inside the vehicle. So they're like, all right, back to the drawing board again. We're just going to, you know, kind of hybridize elements of these two designs. And voila, we get Pepsi.
Literally a Conan O'Brien. What if they mated?
Speaking of mating.
Uh-oh.
Hey, Conker.
This was
before the dark times. As someone who not only played Diddy Kong Racing, but owned Conker's Pocket Tales, that was a sharp turn.
I can't remember if I've shared this before, but when Conker's Bad Fur Day started, like, I don't think I knew of it until the commercials started to come on TV. And if you know the American commercial for Conker, he's literally fucking a human woman. It is a realistic squirrel puppet, like... Look, man, maybe I was just we talked about how maybe I was a sheltered little kid, but it scared the shit out of me. I was like, what is this allowed?
Conker is fascinating because like my first experience with Conker was this game. He was just this cute little squirrel guy. Yeah. And yeah, I would see like in the magazines, they talk about like, oh, 12 Tales Conker 64 is coming out. It's going to be a cutesy little game. And I've seen footage of it. It's like this lovely little like, it feels like a Silly Symphonies kind of inspired game.
He's got a funny
game.
Little strut to him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he's just a little nutty in this game, which is, hey, it's worth the pun.
Yeah, sometimes he's just like, like, oh, he's mentally unwell. And little did I know how far that was going to go in the future.
Oh,
when
man.
They just
when it turns out he's arguably the most sane person in his entire universe.
Yeah. The wild thing about it is like thinking because what were the reasons they went with Bad Fur Day? Was it because Banjo was like it was too close to Banjo, which was being worked on by the other team?
Basically, yeah, it was like, you know, Banjo came out first, even though Conker started development first, and by that time it was like, okay, this is too similar to Banjo. There are too many cutesy 3D platformers out. We need something to set ourselves apart. Oh, I know. Let's make it foul.
I know, let's bring out a sex game on the Nintendo 64.
I know.
I mean, to be fair, they were experimenting with naughtier, well, like, more violent games at the time. Like Resident Evil 2 came out on the N64 at some point, I think.
Yep. Yeah. Was Jet Force Gemini before Conker?
Yep.
Yeah, and even that one was like, yeah, you know, it's shooting and here's some, it's green alien blood. Yeah.
By the way, that just saying that for the sake of this, I'm pretty sure the Great Mighty Pooh was the main inspiration for the Knuckles Sing short, because I've been playing that a lot. Now, not to the same level of, shall we say, content, but it was definitely in my head when I was coming up with the Knuckles Sing song, so there you go.
Clearly that game's greatest legacy. Speaking of characters who show up in other games.
Oh, yeah!
Banjo. Yeah, Tip Top. Wait.
No.
Well, I mean, yeah, Tip Top.
Oh, right. Okay.
Nobody likes you, Tip Top.
Actually, I think you'll find lots of people really like Tip Top. He's kind of like a favored character, I think, by a lot of people because he's.
I definitely remember Tip Top getting a lot of play in my house back in the day. Like, I think that he is one of the better characters on the roster.
Yeah, I played him as a bunch. He's real good.
And he's one of the few characters in this game who would actually continue to show up in places.
What I like about Tip Top is his voice. Because most of the time he's just like, "Hi, I'm Tip Top. Hey, wow!" And then all of a sudden he gets hit. He's like, "Rah!"
I know it's a funny Kermit original Tenchi Muyo dub voice.
And then when he comes back in Banjo Kazooie and Banjo Tooie, he's just like, "Meh, meh, 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 meh." And I kind of love it.
Yeah.
And you get to stomp on a bunch of his friends and make them sing.
You know, I'm not about to judge. I did check. Tip Top was not a Banjo character first. They just imported. He was created for Diddy Kong Racing. They just decided to carry him forward because we need a turtle and we have a turtle. Let's just do that.
Oh, they got a turtle at home.
Speaking of reptiles.
Oh, crunch.
So I don't think I ever knew that he was always supposed to be a critter or a Kremlin or a bad guy from Donkey Kong.
I think I assumed he was a Kremlin because of, well, his name begins with K, and sort of like the Diddy Kong connection made me think, well, I know my Donkey Kong, he probably is a Kremlin.
Yeah, they definitely say as much in the manual that he and another Kremlin buddy are like, Diddy Kong's up to something. You go tell the boss. I'm going to, you know, follow him.
Steal a car and follow him.
apparently, Crunch was, well, A, he was originally going to be named Crash with a K. And B, he was originally just going to be a normal crocodile character until Diddy got brought in. They decided, oh, let's just give him a jacket and make him a Kremlin.
Yeah, he sucks. No, I mean, like, I actually really like Crunch as a character. He's just something really charming, sort of like Saturday morning cartoon villain, like minion kind of vibe about him. Like, all this whole cast is like a cartoon, but
yeah, but also he has the objectively worst stats in the game.
Like, oh, yes. I was watching a video someone made of this that really put it into words. Like it was by the Designing For YouTube channel, and they did the whole video on Crunch, and it was designing for frustration in this case, because he's just, it realizes that Crunch is so screwed over by his stats. He's got like a 1 in acceleration and a 1 in handling out of 5. And he's got the highest speed of like the main cast. He's got like, but it's only like 3.5. So you've got this crappy handling, crappy acceleration, and then you don't even have that much higher speed than Banjo in the end for all your efforts. So you're screwed.
And then once you get Drumstick, he's literally higher in every other stat.
Mm.
So damn, sucks to be Crunch.
sucks to be Crunch even.
God, oh, man. Drumstick was my white whale because that was part of the like, ooh, how do you unlock Drumstick? The secret.
Drumstick was a wild one.
Yeah, the secret, you know, the fallen hero of Diddy Kong Racing, and the magazine I had was like, well, you're going to, I don't even remember, you do this, and then one of the frogs on the shore is going to have a little rooster comb, and then you run it over. And yeah. I mean, again, like nine-year-old me was just like, ooh.
It's just the way he talks, isn't it? I'm Drumstick. Does not sound well. I love
old man owl's long lost relative.
I know, because he looks like he reminded me of, again talking about my childhood here, but the Rockadoodle.
I knew you were going to say it.
From the wild as hell Don Bluth film. But then, yeah, his voice doesn't really live up to that cool persona. Because, isn't even in the story where it's like, oh, Drumstick, the island's hero, went to confront Wizpig and was never heard from again.
The best racer on the island, apparently. Even though
citation needed.
Yeah.
Speaking of other island racers, there's Bumper.
Bumper, yeah, there he is. Yeah, the badge. I mean, he's got a cool design, but
he is a little underwhelming, except for one little thing.
Oh,
He's a criminal who's done jail time.
Okay, I've heard about this, but I don't know what the context is. Sorry, is he actually a criminal?
Yeah, no, he has actually done jail time.
Wow.
Basically, to promote Live and Reloaded, Rare put out a promotional email, like, in character as Conker, talking about he would not be caught dead hanging out with any of those guys from Diddy Kong Racing these days. He heard one of them is in jail anyway. And then years later, Rare clarified that it was, in fact, Bumper who was in jail. And then...
Why?
It was not until literally, I think, 3 years ago that somebody asked about it again. And let me see if I can pull up the exact tweet where Rare was like...
get his criminal record out.
yeah, here we go. Oh, Bumper's been a free badger, well, on parole for a while now, and he's superficially sorry for all those bad things he did.
But what did he do?
As part of his conditional parole, they have sealed his records forever. Maybe he was a minor offender.
Well, you know, maybe it's a case of they need to bring him back for like some mission or something, so they've thrown it all out and they're not allowed to talk about it anymore.
He's I'm part sorry. Of the Suicide Squad now.
You've written up here exactly Bumper, totally forgettable, except. And I just hear in my brain the Dark Souls narrator, and then Bumper, so easily forgotten.
I mean, that is literally the most interesting fact about Bumper. Like, we don't get anything about him other than he's a bit of a speed demon.
Well, he ran over someone's granny.
Just never paid all of those speeding tickets.
I mean, like, maybe it was him and Conker, they first discovered the source, and that's how things ended up out there. And Conker, and they're like, oh God, what did you do? Oh no, I'm getting out of here. Good luck out there, buddy. Hey, Conker, come back!
He should have known about those context-sensitive pads. He could have gotten out of it. And then, you know, arguably... probably the most successful character out of this roster is, of course, Banjo.
Hooray!
Good. My first experience with this character was seeing him there. And because all of these characters, like, the whole cast feels like a cast of, like, an old a Saturday morning cartoon or something.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, for sure.
And Banjo was, like, one of them, because you always had, like, some sort of hillbilly character back then, because it was okay to make fun of people like that back then, I guess.
As a hillbilly, I would say it still is. Well,
they're probably not going to put them in cartoons much anymore. Or maybe they will. But this sort of fuzzy lumpkin guy that was sort of there just being like, it was goofy ass voice, literally goofy ass.
I did, yes.
I mean, you know, Banjo's a little bit hillbilly, but he's nowhere near Bumpkin Kong from...
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, Jesus.
Okay, I take it back.
We'll get to that game
later.
I'm
personally offended now.
Look up this character,
we'll talk about him in a bit, but...
Yeah. Sorry, I need a second. Damn.
Jeremy, this is what they think of you.
I know, he's racist against a type of person that doesn't actually exist. Wow.
Yeah, I tell you what, my moonshine's brewing and my sister's looking fine tonight.
Cranky Kong standing next to him like he is contractually obligated to be there.
He's like, I never thought I'd say this. I miss Lanky.
He looks like one of Scooby-Doo's cousins. Like, he had one like
he has big Scooby-Dumb energy.
That was it. Oh, God. That was his name, wasn't it? Yep. Jesus Christ.
Banjo. I love Banjo.
Banjo. I never play as Banjo in this game, but Banjo-Kazooie is still my favorite game of all time, and I will tolerate no disrespect in this house.
Nah. Banjo's great for if you're, like, specifically against one of the bosses. I discovered once you play as Banjo, it solves everything, because he's a heavy character, and he will spill his way down the stage, so... That's the only thing I use Banjo for. I love Banjo, though. Even if he's not my favorite character to play as in here, I love that he's there.
Exactly. It is interesting that I'm pretty sure that this might technically take place before Banjo-Kazooie, because like it says in the manual, even before the start of his future partnership with Kazooie, Banjo isn't one to turn down the chance of an adventure.
Ah. So, like, well, this is clearly the before times anyway. We know that much.
It is interesting that they do even mention Kazooie in the manual, despite the fact that game was not out yet. So.
Oh. Yeah, but it was being worked on. They knew it would come out after this one.
Yeah.
Which I think that is some of the inherent charm to a lot of these, this era of Rare games, where I'm sure they didn't really think about it that much, but they did create like a Rare universe where, yeah, they're just going to pick and choose like characters that have been in other games. Like, oh, let's take, you know, let's do a racing game with this little tiger, or, oh, we'll do another collectathon with Conker. And then that gets tooled into something else. But I just like it.
It is interesting that it also, you know, kind of ties in with the Mario universe, given, you know, both its origins and the fact that Diddy did loop his way back into the Mario games during that time. So
yeah,
to Mario Kart as well. So he's playing for both sides.
Exactly. But there is still one last playable character. Charming, but oh my god, it took so long to unlock this guy back in the day.
I didn't realize this was what you had to do to get him, but yeah, a lot of work to get this guy, but worth it. This clock motherfucker.
TT is broken as all hell, and it's 100% worth it.
Yeah. Full disclosure, I didn't use a lot of cheats when I finally replayed this game. I did use TT, which might as well be a cheat.
Hell yeah.
And I also use TT, but it's like I unlocked him legitimately. I feel no remorse doing it this way.
Which remind me, you have to beat all of his time attack time trials to unlock him, correct?
Yeah, you have to set the record on a track, and then he'll be like, well done, now try to beat my time. And then to race his ghost.
Yeah, you have to beat TT's.
I get it.
Let me tell you, like, there is very little like margin for error in those time trials. Like, if you want to beat him, it takes a lot.
Better know what these courses look like.
But if you can get him, you will never play as anyone else ever again. Yeah, he's just that good.
Yeah, not bad for a guy with a pitched up voice that echoes all the time whenever he talks.
Yeah, it's kind of a shame because I'm sorry, but playing as him, he's kind of an ugly character because he's just a clock. And of
he's
course,
just a circle.
For visibility, I'm sure, and probably technical reasons, they remove the key that he has when he's just wandering around, and he's just got this, you know, empty key slot on his back when you're playing as him. But hey, that's the trade-off. You get to play as the most broken character, but he's kind of ugly to look at,
especially if you look at his Diddy Kong Racing DS render, which
no,
oh my gosh,
Sonic
like
Schoolhouse looking ass.
God, you're right. He is way too rendered.
Speaking of clocks,
he's been to war. He's seen things.
I mean, he seems like a nice enough bloke, but
yeah, there are other characters outside of the main playable ones, though.
I just like the fact that when you're on the menu screen, it has a different iteration of the theme that plays when you select them. That's so good.
Yeah, I love the dynamic music there. I did some digging. There is an unused one of those that has very familiar sounding instrument that ties in with the next character on the list, which suggests to me that at one point Taj the Genie was meant to be playable.
Oh, I know that happens eventually in the DS version.
Yep. But oh, Taj, where do we start with you?
Yeah, I mean, look, we'll just say like he has a goofy Indian accented English voice. It's so over the top and silly, and it's not even what a person with that accent sounds like. I totally see why they when they did partially remake this for the DS, they decided to not do that. But he's a nice enough guy. the fictional character, I guess. This is he's the guardian genie of this island, correct?
Yep. And he got kicked out of his whatever by Wizpig, which is why, you know, in the ending it changes back to his face as opposed to WizPigs.
See him face.
Well, can I mention one more thing about Taj that I want to get y'all's input on?
Oh yeah, sure.
When you beat the races and get the golden balloon from him, what is it that you think he says? Because, I mean, more than likely, it's just probably him saying, like, hey, but...
He's saying, wahey!
That's okay, a very British thing to say.
Yes, yeah, so he's saying, wahey! And I remember, again, because I think I played these concurrently, picking it out because the polar bears in Banjo-Kazooie prominently say, wahey!
Because, like, for me, like, especially with that accent, whenever I beat a race and got the balloon, when he comes in screen, I think he says, ladies!
Where are all the bitches at?
It's just Pipsy. Okay, never mind.
Yeah. Gonna have to wait for the DS on that one.
Tiny! What? Wait.
Whoa, you ain't tiny anymore.
Wait till the GameCube.
We'll get there.
Jeez.
But there are also a lot of boss battles in this game, which is something I wish more kart races would do. Like,
yeah, it's cool.
Again, Crash Team Racing.
Funny you talk about Crash Team Racing. There's actually something that very closely ties that game with this one that we'll talk about later. But there are four kind of sub bosses for each world. There's Tricky the Triceratops, who was meant to become that Tricky.
Yeah, I did wonder when I read the name. I was like, hang on a
From
minute.
Dinosaur Planet Adventures.
Yeah.
fun fact, originally that game was going to be an adventure game starring Timber, and Tricky would have been his sidekick. And then it became Saber, and then it became Fox.
Interesting.
And Crystal. And Crystal.
And Crystal.
There is Bluey the Walrus. Go ahead and insert that theme there. there is Bubbler the Octopus, and there is Smokey the Dragon, which I feel like he's trying to do some kind of voice, like almost a very bad Arnold impression, but like...
Oh, yeah, because the other ones are pretty... Like, Tricky is like... I mean, he ends up sounding...
Ken. Now try my new challenge.
Yeah, I even think that voice carries into Star Fox Adventures somewhere.
With all the giant dinosaurs that are in there that sound a bit like that, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
These all sound like, you know, big cartoony villains as well.
Yeah, like Bluey sounds like an old-timey prospector. Well done.
Oh, see, I thought he was kind of like an upper crust, kind of like Downton Abbey valet guy.
Well, he's got that little like the breast coat. I think it is from like a
what do you call that?
I'm not sure what you call it, but it's that little thing. Just like it's almost like a little bib that someone would wear when eating lobster. Oh, actually.
I think it is called a bib because you would wear it under your suit jacket.
Yeah,
from Looney Tunes, somebody'd get frustrated and it would. Flap up and hit them in the face. Yeah.
And then Bubbler has just got like he's doing the like.
And then when you're racing against him, he's just like. Some people thought he was saying like I was reading comments of people because I needed to watch videos of this race to be good at it, and people were saying like, "What's he saying? Alcohol? Capone!"
That N64 compression will make you mishear a lot of things.
Ladies!
Yeah. I like him, though. He's just a great cartoon octopus. I love a good cartoon cephalopod.
And then Smokey was, like, Bubbler and Smokey were always the bosses that I had the most trouble with back in the day.
They're
just because of all the traps they would leave behind.
I had to restart a few times for Smoker or Smokey.
Smoker!
It is worth pointing out that these are all like guardians of the island that were just hypnotized by WizPig into becoming his like subordinates. So
That's what makes it interesting, because for me, when I played this as a kid, I remember these being a lot more aggressive than I thought they were. I thought they were mocking me when I was a kid. I thought they were just like, ah, you loser, try to beat me. But then I'm playing it now and they're just like, hey, kid, you got to my challenge, did you? That's great. Well, go on and give it your all. And I'm like, oh, wow, they're actually really supportive for a bunch of hypnotized guardians.
Collect my silver coins and free my soul from the magic prison.
Every second is agony.
a single dad trying to get by based on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I desire free thought.
And of course, Whizpig, but I'm sure that we will have a lot to
say
about
that. We'll get to that guy.
Oh boy, this guy. Oh boy, he stinks.
I got bored, so I took a dump on your lawn.
The cool thing that Diddy Kong Racing did to set itself apart was the three vehicles you had, the car, the hovercraft, and the plane. And, you know, the car was very much just what they did with what most kart racers did with like Mario Kart 64 and everything. But I would say everybody instinctively went for the plane every time in my house and probably most houses just because it was so different.
Now, I can interject here. Because as a 9-year-old child, I loved the hovercraft to where I tried to convince my parents that I could build one out of an inner tube and a
hell
vacuum cleaner
motor.
You did. And we never got past that drawing up little kid blueprints, but I was obsessed with the hovercraft. Probably because this game might have introduced me to the concept of a hovercraft and right. Learning that it was a real thing. I was like, oh my God, it's oh man, it's just I will never forget that as a little kid. I was every time, like I said, when I couldn't progress in the game any farther, I would just switch to the hovercraft and zip around the island.
That's impressive. I'm always surprised to hear that someone likes playing the hovercraft, because I find it frustrating, even if I think it's cool, because I do really like the water stages. I like, at least, I like the idea of them. They look great. They feel great. There's a summery vibe about going around on the ocean in these little things. But it is, it takes some practice to get used to that thing.
Yeah, it really does. It is interesting, too, and maybe it's just because I played this, and not too long ago, I played Wave Race 64 on Switch Online, and finding... I don't know if it was intentional, but like some of the physics and like steering are kind of comparable on the hovercraft. So
for sure,
I'd love that stupid thing. Little kid me was so excited.
Like I was never huge on the hovercraft just because the handling was always so kind of finicky to like really get it to work. Right.
You can't drift, but you can hop.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I did a lot because that was the only way to like kind of kill my momentum so I could try to make some of those sharper turns.
Yep.
They had the bananas like the coins in Mario Kart where if you get up to 10, then it will increase your top speed. But
now,
I think
is that true? Because
that is
when
100%
I was
true.
Okay. Because I was doing research for this, looking for, I think I was looking for strategies, and maybe it was when I was looking for, like, the cheat files for the RetroArch, which is how I played this game. But I saw, like, some old threads and discussions of, like, people talking about how we're pretty sure it increases your top speed, but and I was like, wow, one of those like they didn't actually know.
You don't know if it's a placebo thing, but
yeah,
no,
until they probably analyze the game.
It's not a huge effect, but it definitely is there.
There are times when I just couldn't catch up with the lead. I'm like, what am I doing wrong? I'm playing so well. I've literally got zero bananas. Well,
yeah. Right.
I think the more interesting item, though, are the balloons. Like, I love that concept of, you know, getting multiple of the same item type to increase its power. I think that
is instead of random items like in Mario Kart, you can see which ones you want to aim for.
Yeah, like, there's a lot more strategy as a result, I think.
And I'm always like, if I'm getting the missiles, I'm like, I've got to get at least two so I can get a homing one, because it's a crapshoot otherwise. Because they are like the green shells that become red shells and then become 10 of them, because why not?
It is interesting that in the DS version, they changed that order so that the multiple ones were the second tier and the homing missile was the third tier.
That does make sense, because again, I'm remembering my memories that because it was potentially so difficult to aim the little rockets that it almost felt like a downgrade if you grabbed that third red balloon and got 10 little missiles instead of the homing one, which is like almost a guaranteed hit.
Yeah, I really like this whole system, like being able to switch between, okay, I want to go offensive. Okay, I need a boost now. Okay, I need to set a trap behind me. Like being able to like strategize on the fly and figure out what's, you know, works best for that scenario, and then the risk reward of trying to get the higher tier item. I think that's really good. It's something that I feel like a lot of other kart racers don't do. There's definitely a few like Lego Racers and Crash Team Racing, but this is definitely the one that I feel like to have the biggest impact.
And if you're going to get a boost, like you're either using the zippers or you're using the blue balloons, and you've got to, like, I'm so glad Tarts told me about like letting go of the gas right before you, right as it hits, because that makes a huge difference. Yes. You want to get that green boost and keep it going until it starts like flashing rainbow colored, and then like press down again immediately so you don't lose it. Because once I work that out, I was zipping through these stages.
I feel like,
man,
even though Taj tells you about the green boost, it's one of those things that like, back in the day, nobody ever knew. So if you figured that out and you were like able to use that, you felt like the king of the world. Like you felt like you knew, had forbidden knowledge that, you know.
I think you clued me into that, Cyberlink, because I had forgotten about the green boost. But then I did get a tip, which was the, somebody tells you, it's probably Taj, but it was like, oh, try tapping the brake once you're drifting. And if you're playing as TT, that is how you get around some of those corners, is the, I don't know what you would call it, a super drift e-brake slide.
You gotta have that drift to use to do the silver coin challenges.
For sure.
Otherwise, 100%. You're having to go back and get them, and it's just like, oh man, no.
Like, the drifting isn't as tight as something like, you know, Sonic All-Stars Racing, but it's still pretty good. I miss not getting, you know, the boost like you would in Mario Kart or Sonic.
Though. Yeah. It's one of those to where, even though there's not a reward like Mario Kart, is you kind of have to force yourself to learn how to use it, because it is necessary. Thankfully, I don't know if it was just this time around, the hitboxes, the window on picking up items seems pretty generous, as far as like, oh, I don't think I'm going to get that coin. Oh, no, I got it. I was close enough.
It's generally pretty good.
And I think it's cool that the balloons are also like the your equivalent of, you know, power stars in this game, too.
Yeah.
the pretty shiny golden balloons.
I mean, it's a rare game, so this game has a lot of collectibles.
Yeah. Oh, cool. Not absurd levels, but yes, there is lots to do.
Yeah. As including battle modes, which is, again, something that I didn't always have access to, because you do need to unlock them. And
it's not that bad, though, because you just need to go find them in the stage and then exit out and you get it. So fair enough.
You don't have to win, thank God.
I did find that I still remember the location of every single key in that game.
I had to look all but the I think I might have found two. I definitely had to look a couple up because
the first one's thankfully right in plain view, but.
The final one is great, though.
Yeah.
Like, it's so good. Like, it's a pain to get, but when you find out, you're like, oh, you sneaky bastards. Gotta bring up the drawbridge.
And I love that they incorporate the multiplayer mode into the single player. Like, that's just cool. I like it.
Yeah.
You know, it's just you playing against computer-controlled characters, but I just think it's neat.
Yeah. Like, I appreciate that there are, like, some of them have other like mission types instead of just standard deathmatch, even though I will fully admit deathmatch was the type that I played the most back as a kid.
Yeah.
Are you sure you weren't hatching those eggs? Cause that was a fun little one. But
For some reason, I think I remember the eggs probably causing the most arguments when I played with my younger sister, because of like, the whole point is you steal everyone else's eggs.
Yeah, the Capture the Bananas one was definitely like the one I played the least. Like even now, I don't think that one's as strong as the other three.
Yeah, it's interesting on paper, but execution, it's just a little bland.
Yeah, but the thing people remember this game for above all else is that adventure mode. More kart racers need to do that. Like, Crash Team Racing is the only one that I can, like, that's one of the few that totally stole this, and I wish more would do it.
Bro, if they did a true sequel to Sonic and All-Stars Racing Transformed and just put an adventure mode in it.
I thought that's what they were going to do with it originally, based on how they were describing it.
Undisputedly the greatest kart racing video game ever created by humans.
I would love that. I genuinely would love that.
Maybe someday.
Team Sonic Racing had a story mode, but no, yeah. It's not the same. It's not the same as this.
Like, I realized, you know, going back to play it, it's a pretty small world, but just like having that freedom to move around and like little things for you to discover, it's just really, really cool.
I can understand, like, maybe it's not straightforward enough for people who just want to, like, have a Grand Prix, so to speak, like your typical kart racing thing, but come on, man. This is cool.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of appreciate the fact that it took me a while to find the woods hidden in the waterfall.
that took me a while, too.
I had beaten Bubbler, and I'm like, oh, I know there's four. Where is it again? And I just started looking behind waterfalls.
There's always something behind the waterfall.
And if there's not, that's a failure of the game design.
Exactly.
So that one old school pop song that says don't go chasing waterfalls is incorrect in this situation.
100%.
Not if you're a capital G gamer.
There's a fair amount to do in that adventure mode too, because it's like, you know, they've got some balloons hidden around the overworld. You can do, you know, you do challenges with Taj to unlock like the different vehicle types and get some extra balloons. But the main thing is that, you know, every like it's divided into multiple different quote unquote worlds with four tracks each. And like there's you got to do a lot to complete those worlds. But I also appreciate that, like, you know, you've got the golden balloons as the power star equivalent, like we talked about. And I appreciate that, you know, you don't have to finish all of one world to move on to the next one. They kind of encourage you to jump around. Like you can, you can mostly stick to one world as long as you are, you know, finding the one, like all the hidden ones in the overworld. But like, I appreciate that they give you, like, they kind of encourage you to mix it up a little bit.
And I like the how well the courses are designed, because they're going back to the Mario Kart comparison. They're very short by comparison, but they're as long as they need to be. Like, I feel like especially modern Mario Kart, like some of these four separate courses would just be combined into one like mega course. But all of the ones in Diddy Kong Racing are themed after, like, you know, they're different, like Dino Domain all have like a, you know, like a cartoony Flintstones dinosaur fossils and volcano themes.
Sorry, Jeremy, just when you said Dino Domain, I immediately heard TT's voice in the back of my head. Dino Domain!
Ancient Lake. Fossil Canyon.
Hot Top Volcano.
What a silly guy.
Yeah.
But I remember thinking that too, going back to like, oh yeah, there's four courses in each one, and oh boy, this is gonna be, and it is a lot. It's a lot to do, but I really do think the course designs are very solid, and even for being so much shorter compared to others. There except for one. We'll get to it.
It is good that the course designs are as solid as they are, because you have to play all of them at least three times.
Yeah, yes. It can be a little bit repetitive after a while, especially once you're doing like the silver coin challenges and then the trophy challenges and then
and if you're gonna do the time trials.
Yeah. But hey, you're gonna get to learn these courses really well. So good luck.
And you do learn those courses really well, because, like, I go back and replay these, and I'm like, oh, yeah, I know all of the routes. I know all the shortcuts. Like, that stuff sticks with you.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good, even though, you know, you could argue that they fall into some, like, video game, whatchamacallit, like, settings. Like, oh, Dino Domain is kind of a fire stage, Snowflake Mountain. Oh, it's snow and ice and whatever. But, like, Sherbet Island and Dragon Forest are, I think, really where it, like, stands out as being its own unique thing, because there's so many more like hovercraft courses in Sherbet Island, and it's not just the plane, like, you know, like I said, Wave Race 64.
Yeah.
And then Dragon Forest is really cool how it's like it's like never the same thing twice. It's very varied.
Yeah, you don't see a lot of like medieval themed tracks, or at least like not as part, like you'll see them occasionally in some racing games, but not as like a whole, you know, sub world basically.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if that goes back to this being like a Disneyland world inspired.
Right.
I think you're right on the money.
Of having, oh, different kingdoms and themes.
Yeah, I suppose that makes more sense for it being like a little, because I know we have like little hub worlds with wildly varying levels within them in these sort of games, but it almost would make more sense if this was a theme park from that perspective.
You got to do every course three times, you know, once the first time through, then once for the silver coin challenges.
That was my downfall as a child.
I'd rather have silver dollar pancakes.
Me too. These sort of get replaced in the DS version. I don't know that I like the replacement any better, but these silver coin challenges were like a run breaker for me, and I'm sure a lot of other people.
Yeah.
Like, especially in the latter portions of the game. Like,
yeah.
Gotta get those the handling right and gotta know where they all are. Like, you have to basically do a crap run first to be like, okay, I'm gonna play this slowly and work out where everything is. Yeah. And then you have to play it again and try, like, okay, I've got all the coins, but I'm in eighth place. Fuck.
Yeah, I would have much preferred, you know, what some other racing games do where it's like, it's basically a gates challenge where you gotta go through all the gates in order. Like, I feel like those are usually like a lot more forgiving than, you know, something like the silver coin challenge.
Because if we didn't say, you have to collect all eight of these coins that are scattered in sometimes obvious, sometimes like hiding places, shortcuts, and place first in the race. And because some of these courses are very tiny, that can be really tough to grab these coins and maintain your lead, especially if you haven't unlocked the secret characters, which you can't without doing this first.
Right.
I'm realizing that Sonic R came out around the same time and did the same thing to unlock its playable characters in that, but it's so much easier there.
Yeah, it's
God. Sonic did it better. Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's Sonic R is it's still tricky to get those emeralds and coins, but it's much more doable than Diddy Kong Racing. That's for sure.
Yeah, you got to do that. You got to do the trophy race where you do the full Grand Prix run for each world. You got to find the key to unlock the battle mode stage, and that'll get you a piece of the TT amulet. There's just, you know, like I said, Rare was kind of in a habit of sticking collectibles in anything back during this time, and it really shows in this one.
This one does feel like maybe this is a way of just extending it to get you the most, like, make sure that you didn't finish it too quickly. It's just like, well, we don't have enough worlds, so do this three times. Good luck.
Yep. And then, you know, I feel like this is an early example of like, now collect all the trophies for the true final challenge, kids.
Yep. Like, you gotta, like, including having to fight every boss twice as well. One of them a little bit harder on the second time around after the silver coins, which I love those boss races. Like, they can get tough, sure, but like, They felt like a real showdown to me. Like, I love how if you get a lead on them.
Oh, no.
Cheese it.
They're coming for you.
Well, what did Bumper get up to this time?
I love how if you get a lead on them, like, you can get, like, really far ahead the bosses, but then you start, like, especially if you've got the rumble pack in, you start hearing the shaking of the ground and feeling it rumble. It's like,
oh, I missed that feeling.
It's so satisfying just feeling it going as you hear the, like, footsteps coming up close behind you. Like, it really ratchets up the tension in a way that I just
Well, the music's going
just like, oh, no. Yeah, we're going to talk about the music later because it deserves to be like, talked about on its own. But, oh, it's just so good. So to kind of like, we're going to run through the tracks real quick. If there's one that like jumps out at you guys as like super memorable, then, you know, just stop there.
Yeah, absolutely. I can think of one.
Yeah, we'll get there. Ancient Lake, I think, is a really good like first stage. It's just a simple circuit, but like.
Oh, it's the perfect introduction to this game, I'd argue.
Yeah.
Like, Luigi's circuit, get out of here. It's Ancient Lake all the way.
Yeah, like, it teaches you, like, you've got the key right out in the open to let you know, hey, you can find these to get the battle stages. All of the silver coins are out in the open to teach you like the basics of, you know, finding, collecting them. They've got, you know, very simple shortcuts like the one over the grass to kind of show you the advantages there. Like it's a perfect tutorial stage.
And it's all caveman.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's for the whole of Dino Domain. It was like harkening back to the SNES era of millions of caveman related games.
I know. I love that big, cyan, like, brontosaurus just stomping around.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a little miffed that they're, like, big raptor things or whatever are only in the intro for Fossil Canyon and not in the stage itself.
Oh, yeah.
I like those little guys. They're cute. Fossil Canyon is pretty good. Jungle Falls might be my favorite track on the N64 soundtrack. Like that one I always really love, just like going through the big tunnel and then driving through the dinosaur bones. Like,
yeah,
it's really cool. Hot Top Volcano was another one that really stuck with me as a kid because it was the first like dedicated playing stage.
Yeah, yeah.
Although you could also do the hovercraft on that one, but like I would always go playing. Like, how could you not?
Naturally.
Yeah, don't you, once you turn the time trial mode on, then you can choose your vehicle for a couple of stages?
Yeah,
you can't like, choose car for Hot Top Volcano or you would die.
Yeah, like, once you beat the stage the first time with the vehicle you have to do it with, if you can do other vehicles in that one, that's when they'll let you do it. But
very cool.
It's just very cool, and that's one of the, like, stages that I remember getting a lot of multiplayer play, although one complaint about the multiplayer is that if you have like three or four characters, they do not play the music in any of the stages, and that's frustrating.
Oh, probably wow. To save memory on 100%,
but
that old N64.
I get it, but that doesn't mean I have to like it.
Yep.
Snowflake Mountain. I don't know why I always think of this as World 3 instead of World 2. I just do. But
it's weird to almost have a snow level be second, I think is what it is.
Maybe. Like Everfrost Peak, that one's pretty good. Walrus Cove, I always remember because of the big loop and then driving through the big loop, like when you're up above. It's a really cool set piece there.
I can't remember if it's Snowball Valley or Frosty Village that has the music that I most associate with this game, because there's a little refrain where it just sounds like a person going, wah, 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 wah. I mean, that just got stuck in my head forever. Like, would sing it along, would say it to my sister, and she'd crack up because she knew what it was. And
I think you're thinking of Snowball Valley.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Yeah, Snowball Valley is an interesting one because of like the split right at the start, but also like the big canyon where the snowballs are rolling at you, and like the Mount Rushmore with Bumper and I think Tipped Up and Pepsi. Maybe that's the crime, is like emblazoning himself on you know, public property.
Yeah, he had no business putting his face on there, of all things. People were like, who the hell is that guy? I don't remember him.
He's trying to set up his living legacy.
Mount Bumpmore up there. And then Frosty Village is definitely the one from Snowflake Mountain that I remember the clearest, just because, like, you know, it was kind of like one of the few that was set like at nighttime with Starry Sky. It had that big section that was all foggy that I remember. Like,
yeah, I was about to say, surprisingly nice looking fog, which I know nowadays we realize was like an intentional like design choice to make up for draw distance. But it looks really good here. And the fact that you can take a huge alternate route in that section, like amongst the giant trees as well.
Yeah, it is interesting that that's like the one case where they do actually use the fog as like, it's just super foggy in this section alone, but the rest of the track is completely clear. Like, it's a cool effect.
It's pretty good. Like, I just love that it's got like the little houses. But just for one little section, you're going past, it's like this little bit is actually a little little village that you go past. So many there are lots of wintry vibes through all these stages, but that just has that sort of like, oh, it's a lovely little wintry town.
Mm-hmm.
A little freezy peakish, actually, now I think about it.
Yeah, I would not be surprised if there was some influence there.
I was going to say, it's maybe I'm just overanalyzing it, but I really appreciate, like you said, the artistic value of populating this, some world building, like, oh, there's houses here. That means people live here. And
yeah, and they're probably like, oh, now here come the races again.
These little fuzzballs. I ran right into my window.
he's trying to get that silver coin again, isn't he?
You know what? I'm going to grab that silver coin. I'm going to take it inside just to spite him. Sherbert Island is another one. Like, I think this is, like you said, the one where things really start to differentiate themselves because so much of it is hovercraft based. So it's like, you know, you start off with Whale Bay, which has like the sunken pirate ship, and the whale will come up every once in a while and use as a ramp. Like, I think that this is the one where it's like, if you have not learned how to use a hovercraft up to this point, this is how we're going to teach you. And I think that this is one of the better ones to do that.
And if you haven't been keeping an eye out for those rainbow balloons with the super magnet power up, that'll also teach you to keep an eye out for those.
Right.
Now, Crescent Island, I think, might be the most interesting track in this game. For reasons that have nothing to do with Diddy Kong Racing, because when Naughty Dog was first making Crash Team Racing, they actually recreated Crescent Island in that game's engine, because it's like, well, this is a really good track from another racing game. So if we can put this in our racing game and it still plays really, really good, then we know that our gameplay is good. And that is that is why that first stage in Crash Team Racing has a sunken pirate ship.
Okay.
That's interesting.
And you know what? Now that you mention it, even like the layout between Crescent Island and like the first temple level in Crash Team Racing, like, it's kind of familiar, like, especially that last like turn before you get to the finish line in Crescent Island. Like, parts of it just like
look, it's got that vibe.
Yeah. Wow.
I think I remember hearing that maybe there was a track meant for this that one didn't make it into the final game itself, but it was replaced for the final version. Like, music-wise, music track, not the track on top of the track.
There is an unused music track. I'm not sure if it was for this one, but I do have that one. It's still in the data. We'll talk about that when we get to the music.
Yes.
But, Crescent Island, really good track. Totally makes sense that they stole it. Pirate Lagoon, another, like, hovercraft-focused track that I really like. I love, like, the ship, like, I love the whole shipwrecked pirate theme to all of these tracks. Like, I think this was one of the ones that I struggled a lot with on the Silver Coin Challenge in particular. Just the handling really kind of messing with you when you're trying to get those last couple of silver coins and still maintain your lead.
Yeah.
I remember multiple times trying to, like, get that jump at the end just right to make that shortcut. Like, the few times I managed to get it was just so satisfying.
Yeah. So you mentioned handling. I think this is kind of a good time to maybe quickly mention that, like, I definitely appreciate and have played a lot of this era of racing, like Mario Kart Racing, Diddy Kong Racing, Crash Team Racing especially. But one thing that's, like, kind of common in this era is that sort of slippery, drifty feel of turning where it doesn't feel like the tires are fully gripping the road. Just to be totally forthright, I've been playing a lot of Rocket Racing on Fortnite recently, and it just controls so good. And going from that back to this, I have to, like, kind of rewire my brain for a second. Like, okay, there's slip, so I have to anticipate moving a little bit sooner or a little bit later. And yeah, that little bit of, like, drift where it doesn't feel like the tires are fully grasping the road, it takes some getting used to.
Yeah, that slip is definitely, like, the biggest reason why I do not generally go back to Mario Kart 64 over some of the later games. You do have to kind of rewire yourself a little bit, but, you know, it's manageable once you get yourself in that headspace. And then I'd really like Treasure Caves, just the kind of cool, like, indoor cave, like, ship's graveyard aesthetic throughout most of that stage. Like, I think it just is one of the cooler looking stages in general. And then jumping forward to Dragon Forest, Windmill Plains, like, I feel like that's one of the less played stages in my time with that game back in the day, where compared to a stage where I had maybe too much time spent there for reasons outside of my control.
I will say I do. I think Windmill Plains, it might be my favorite Plains stage. Oh. Just thinking about it. Yeah, I just like how it, I guess because the, like the little bonus items and like zipper things that you can get in the windmill seem a little easier to actually swoop down and get compared to like, I think it's, what is it? Spaceport Alpha in Future Fun Land, which is a fun stage, but is so hard to like, there's so much going on and so many weird open spaces with the plane that, I don't know. I just, Windmill Plains is a nice tight little canyon stage with the plane that I really enjoy.
I'm surprised because I don't know if other people liked having tight stages when it comes to the plane ones. Like part of the appeal of the plane is being able to fly all around a little bit. But yeah, I can understand like it keeps you on track, like especially like it flying through all the holes and taking all those corners and the tunnels and whatnot.
Yeah, I think I'm also thinking of like the last big stretch before the finish line, which is just, it is a big wide open canyon, but you can hug that wall and get, I think you have to get at least one silver coin.
Yeah.
And like sometimes the computer is just too dumb to do it. And so you'll just zip right past them.
Speaking of silver coins.
Oh, Greenwood Village. Ugh. Even with the cheating character, this is so hard to do.
This is easily the hardest silver coin challenge in the entire game, which is a shame because I like the stage otherwise.
It's a great aesthetic, isn't it? It's like this lovely, it's a village. It's a little medieval village.
I think about this one a lot, mostly because a ROM hack of Banjo-Kazooie I really like has turned Greenwood Village into a fully, like, explorable stage.
Oh, nice.
It's really wow. good,
but this one was my white whale for a good long while when I was a kid, just because it is like there's so many tight turns and the like you really kind of got to go out of your way for a lot of those silver coins, especially like I'm thinking immediately of the one where you got to drop down the well and come out that end. Like it's a good shortcut if you can nail it, but like it's tricky.
It's good practice to, doing your braking drifts. And if you don't have the timing on the boost right out of the starting line, you will get it retrying this stage over and over.
You can get like the coin without going through the well if you handle really well. But if people tell you the best way to get that coin, they'll be like, well, actually.
Well.
Yeah, and the fact that you have to get get the one coin on the shortcut that's not really a shortcut, but
yeah,
and then the really tight turns at the end where it's like, oh, I can make this turn, but not to get the coin. And
yeah,
but
I got it
eventually, but it got to a this is not fun anymore point.
I was stuck in fourth place for a long time. It's like, I've got all the coins, I've liked how to get the coins, I've got them all.
Yeah, but that's the thing.
The first place is so far away. I'm like, oh, Diddy, what are you doing over there? How did you get there so fast? Oh, you're not having to collect coins, are you monkey bastard?
this will not be the last time we talk about Greenwood Village in this episode, but we'll save that for later. Boulder Canyon, I think, is one of the coolest stages just because I think it does an incredible job with its dynamic music.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Agreed.
That's really cool. That's like some, that is some like later Rare stuff, you know, having the music change where you go. And I think Mario Kart would take from this later on too.
A little bit, yeah.
I love that. The sort of the changing when you're like when you're on the rapids and then you're in the castle and then you're going through the dungeons of the castle, I guess it is. Oh, it's really good.
And like speaking to what you mentioned earlier about how like levels from this game are kind of reminiscent or inspired from like Disney theme park kind of things, like this definitely feels like a whole journey that you would be on some ride at Disneyland or Disney World or something like that. Like
if they made like a Robin Hood waterfall,
oh, that'd be then, awesome.
You know, it would probably be like this. I know you mentioned it earlier, but that drawbridge, just I love the idea of having this little interactable thing that you can hit to basically cut people off from the main route and force them to go the long way around, especially like it's just being able to sabotage opponents like that without having to use an item. It's just a really cool feature and I like it a lot. And then Haunted Woods. I think Haunted Woods is cool. Like it definitely feels a little bit like Greenwood Village Part 2, but like I like all the little ghosties flying around. It's got a fun aesthetic to it.
Yeah.
It's like right coming right after Greenwood Village. It's so easy. Like that's thing. It's just like it's actually a kind of a relief. It's just like, oh, it's a spooky level, but it's over with before you know it.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was about to say. It's that because it's such a short course, it's like, oh yay, spooky, scary. Oh, well, it's done. And there's nothing else like it. Well, all right, that was fun. I do like a good spooky level in a rare game though.
Are the ghosts in that level Whizpig? It kind of looks like him.
Yeah, they're like little Whizpig heads.
Okay, I thought so. Yeah.
Yeah, they're pretty great. Just these little pig heads like bouncing around the place.
Once you finally beat all the stages, all the coin challenges, all the bosses and everything, you're finally ready to take on Whizpig and oh my god.
Well,
remember how we said that Greenwood Village was the hardest thing in this game? We lied.
Yep, this is. Yeah. I mean, even using the cheating character, if you miss one zipper boost pad in this race, you might as well just restart.
Yeah.
And you basically gotta use the green boost over all of them, which doesn't really work because like it makes you go so much faster that you actually lose control and like will easily like end up getting thrown off of the thing. And it's like, oh, there is no room for error on this race.
You gotta have a perfect run. And you know, it kind of is fitting because it starts off with Whizpig just like appearing from nowhere, from this thunder coming down, lightning crashing. He's just like, brr, 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 brr. He's like, you can't beat me. I'm like, well, we'll see about, oh, shit, I can't.
He's
really that hard. It's something about it. There's something about the combination of like his imposing appearance, the rain coming down, the waterlogged level, the intimidating music, the way he stomps along in a hurry and then T-poses in the air. it's really intimidating. And I'm sure, once again, like I hadn't thought about that, but like playing it with the Rumble Pack as a kid, I'm sure you hear him feel him stomping along as he's catching up with you. Oh, it's a lot. It's a lot, man. He's just a big bully, though. He's just this big, nasty pig. Because, you know, pigs are one of those horrible animals. Well, they're not always. But they are often used with, like, gross, disgusting characters sometimes. And here is just this big guy.
Whizpig does have a little bit of, like, a very cartoony, even more so than usual, like, you know, like Ganon energy.
Yeah.
Like, oh, he's a big, nasty, mean wizard pig.
He's got a bit of King Koopa from the Super Show sort of like vibe to his voice too. He's constantly like this.
It kind of feels like that's what they're going for. It's not, I mean, the I can't tell if the quote unquote actor is trying to suppress their natural accent or not, but it's just comes off as the perfect bully guy voice where, you know, when he shows up right before the first credits roll and again is just running around going booga 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 little worms. It's like, man, what is this guy's freaking problem? Damn.
And like working in the like pig snorting into all of his laughter and everything. It's a nice touch. And I will fully admit, like this race is extremely frustrating, but also I love that boss theme. It's so good.
God, yeah. Like it's the boss theme and the introductory theme because it's so bombastic. But flies down. It's like dun, 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 and then he's just
immediately
into
the race like dun, 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 dun.
Exactly.
It's so good. But if you manage to beat Whizpig, and that is a big if, you get the ending. Yay! Everybody's celebrating on the beach. Except the lighthouse on the beach was his rocket all along. He's going back Whispig's going back to his home planet. He does not die on the way, unfortunately.
I just love it. He's just like this big beast of a character is hiding behind something and they haven't noticed him. He comes out and is like, sorry to break the party, but I had to say goodbye.
See you later, worms. It's cheesy and fun and I love it, but...
With pig ship.
Yeah, his ship comes down and starts shooting at everybody on the beach and it's like, haha, he's a terrorist.
Yeah.
I know, because we were talking about this before we started recording, but the quote-unquote the lore for Whizpig is that he is from an alien planet that he conquered with his magical powers and then got bored, so he decided to travel to...
other places.
Diddy Kong's planet.
I love that he's a space alien wizard who's also a pig. That's a lot of things at once.
That wizard came from the moon.
Yep, he's just an asshole.
And you could say, like, this is like a Saturday morning cartoon, so you can have a simplistic villain that doesn't really have anything going for them other than he is a jerk. Because as I've discovered over the years, it's okay to have these characters because... lots of the world's greatest villains are just jerks.
Yeah. <Yep. laughs>
Look, I'm not saying that Whizpig is, you know, maybe inspired by some previous stuff, but I'm just saying Space Jam did come out 1 year earlier.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man. Oh, does that... Is Whizpig supposed to be a really bad Danny DeVito impression?
It wouldn't surprise me.
I didn't know Dan Aykroyd was in this picture.
So I saw Diddy Kong and I started blasting.
Literally. But if you've beaten all the trophy races, you take the lighthouse rocket up to Whizpig's home planet of Future Funland, because you've got 4 more tracks you're going to have to do the whole thing over again with. No standard boss race, no battle mode thing, just the tracks and the silver coin challenges. But hoo boy.
Dr. Eggman seething that this pig wizard completed his life's dream before he did.
I like the Future Funland tracks. They're definitely like... a little bit on the more difficult side, especially like Faceless Alley's all right. Like that's one of the plane stages. It was a little weird that they've got palm trees in space, but I'm not going to question it.
Who's to say what they can't have in this space, you know? It's another planet.
I wonder if it literally is supposed to be like a theme park. Because
I think it's
Star City is... Star City is almost like another roller coaster, like with those 2 big loops at the end. I believe that's Star City.
Yeah, or no, I think that's Dark Moon Caverns.
Yeah, I think you're right. No, Star City is the one with the big, hey, if you fall off this ramp at the beginning, you might as well restart the course.
Yeah,
because there's no shortcut down there.
I think they added one in the DS version.
I that's the only one where I was like, how do I get back up there? Oh, I go all the way. Well, okay, I'm restarting. Don't drift. Yeah, hit that boost.
Yeah, Dark Moon Caverns is the one that's like going through the moon caverns. Then you've got the double loop, which is very cool. Spaceport Alpha was always the hardest stage for me, just because there's like...
it is tight.
Yeah, there's so many like sharp turns and dips that you got to make. And it's especially bad during that like... stretch where you're doing the Death Star trench run. And
yeah, I wanted to mention that. Yeah.
This is already Star Warsy, and then they just have that part.
Yeah, like that one actually was so difficult that they put out a revision A of the cartridge that toned down the lasers in that section.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah. I think that's the version I played is the one revision that has a few tiny tweaks like that. But it is you want to hit those those booster gates, but you're more than likely going to get blasted in the face with one of those lasers.
Yeah, I know my cartridge is the original revision, not the revision A. So, you know, that's... I know, because A, I did always get shot down, but B, there is little stuff that I noticed that did change between revisions. Like when Taj gives you his tips after being the boss, the music will play first, and then he'll say, I've got something special for you in the revised version, whereas the original, they play at the same time. And the other change is that I can think of is that in Star City, there's this big portion where you're doing like the sharp turns through the cityscape. And one of those buildings has a big old Killer Instinct logo on it they took out of the revision. Evidently, Ultra Tech did not get to expand into other planets just yet.
And then the game is over.
Except for,
and everything's good.
Except for one final race against Whizpig. And,
oh, I try not to think about it. Actually, it's not.
Yeah, honestly, like compared to that first one, Whizpig Strikes Back is so much easier. Like,
at this point, yeah, you're just like, haha, I've got your number now, nerd. So,
it's just a lot easier to overtake him because of, you know, you've got a lot more space to maneuver, and he's not nearly as fast on his big rocket as he is in, like, doing the runs. So it's just a lot simpler. I literally, like, beat it again for Jeremy and Jake, like, off the cuff a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, yeah. And it is another one of those, like, it's a plane race, and once you get the hang of the layout, I did find it really fun to zip in and out of those little, you know, there's so many tiny little passages you got to squeeze through, and like, oh, I know there's a secret boost balloon up here on this, you know, big stupid Whizpig statue, and it was a lot of fun. It's one of the, you know, again, if you're playing this on emulation with some cheats, it's one that definitely has its own cheats. I think it's like infinite boost items, but I ended up not needing that. It was a lot of fun.
It's tough but fair.
Yes, unlike the first Whizpig fight, which is
just no
tough and stupid.
You don't need to be perfect to do this one. You just got to watch out for them lasers, is all.
Right.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, you beat Whizpig. His rocket spirals out of control, crashes onto the moon. You get the ending with everybody in the main hub world celebrating. Credits roll, and then you get a little scene at the end of Whizpig's ship flying off Z Cackles with a "to be continued" message, which
wrong.
They should have done that, not just because it was teasing a sequel that would never come, but I just love the idea that he died there.
No, Whizpig died on the way to somebody else's planet.
Yeah, well, he was like Cars at the end of Battle Tendency, stuck in space, yeah. And eventually he stopped thinking.
Oh, at least Rare learned from that, would never put, like, you know, items or scenes at the end that would tease at a great spawning concept or sequel that would never actually come to proper fruition.
We should probably stop talking about those games and swap back to Diddy Kong Racing this is actually technically not the end of the game, because there's Adventure 2. Jumps in the air.
And what's that?
It's adventure mode, mirror mode. Like, just replay through all the tracks, but in mirror mode, unlock them for, you know, versus mode every time you beat it. Which,
oh, I thought Adventure 2 would be like the mode where they get rid of the hub world, but they introduce like a new character that people really just can't let go of. So when he dies at the end, they have to bring him back. Live and learn, though.
Live and learn. Yeah, no, it's like, it's a quick way to extend the life of the game. But, you know, mirror mode is kind of essential for any kart racer, and it's a decent way to extend that replayability. So, you know, I appreciate it. And then one of the other things I really appreciate about this game is that this was back in the era where everybody loved doing cheat codes, and DKR was no exception, because they would give you a random one in the, like, ending sequence. And there are, like, so many cheats, some of which are, like, I feel like should have been features available without it. Like, there's a cheat that lets two characters play the same character. There's one that lets two people do adventure mode together, stuff like that. But then there's also, like, ones that add, you know, sound test and turns all the balloons to a specific color, or, like, uncaps your banana speed so you just keep getting faster and faster, or makes it so bananas slow you down, which is stuff, and I love it.
Sorry, just the way you phrase that, I just had that sort of like, fuck it, uncaps your banana speed.
I do have like a hacked version for my own use, which is just all of the all of the codes unlocked from the beginning, so you can just toggle them on and off as you like, which is my kind of preferred way to play that game these days. That basically brings us to the end of Diddy Kong Racing. or at least the first version anyway, because as we all know, Microsoft bought out Rare in 2002 to make games for the Xbox. Not going to talk about how successful that was because it'll probably make me sad. But for the first several years, Microsoft was like, yeah, no, we don't see the Game Boy as competition because we don't have a handheld system. Same with the DS. So you want to make some games for that, put out the ones you've already been working on, go nuts. So that is how we got a full remake of Diddy Kong Racing for the Nintendo DS in 2007, which is still wild to me that it even happened.
Of course, had to make some compromises to get it out.
There were some changes, yes. I'm curious if any of you guys, if any of you guys besides me played this when it was new.
This came out in a weird era of, I'm trying to remember, 2007. And I remember I never picked this one up, and it might have just been a lack of free time because I think I was starting college and was probably playing my DS a lot, but, you know, between college and working a job all the way through college as well, it was like, okay, I just got to play the games I got. And also I do remember seeing like people talking about like the differences, and I might have just been busy with other things and just became one of those that I never personally got.
Yeah, this would have been, I think, like one of the last big games to come out, like right before switching over from high school to college. And in my mind, I still remember like spending time playing it while waiting for, you know, some of the people I was carpooling with to, you know, swing by. But I remember thinking it was okay, but I definitely remember that like a lot of the changes they made to it were not super great in my opinion, which is probably why that one was like just a rental for me and I didn't end up buying it until several years later when I found a copy for super duper cheap. But it does do some interesting things, let's say. I'm curious if the other two of you ever played it as well.
I was gonna that's the kind of thing, like, I knew of it, but I was just like, oh, they brought out Diddy Kong Racing for the DS, I'd like to play. Oh, my guys aren't in it anymore.
Yeah,
maybe I'll wait. And then I just never did play it. So, you know, I mean, and from what I understand, it has its issues, but it's just cool we got another release of it, I suppose.
There's things I like and things I don't.
I did play a teeny bit of it in the lead up to this, and I might play some more after this just because I've never experienced it. But out of the gate doing the first couple of races, it does just feel different. Not as it feels a little slower than the 64 version.
Yeah.
You know, not that the 64 version is like amazing. Like a lot of N64 games, I'm sure it was framey, but on original hardware, but it feels a little slower. The camera angle is a little different. It was actually a little disorienting because I don't know if you can adjust this, but it switches between the top and bottom screens a lot. Yeah, and like you've put down here, all of the DS gimmicks to use the stylus are annoying to infuriating. Like, how are you supposed to? Are you supposed to have your stylus out the whole game?
And yeah,
that's how you get the boost off the starting line. That sucks, man. No, don't do that.
Yeah, I see. I saw, like, I was watching like someone's long play to at least get an idea of it. And yeah, just seeing like it pop up at the bottom, being like spin or blow, like for the hovercraft, I was like, oh,
like,
man,
having
really?
A blow to get the hovercraft engine going for the boost is like the most infuriating thing in the world.
No thanks.
Yeah, it blows.
Yes, especially if you're having to replay a stage a bunch, like the bubbler race, where it's like retry. Okay. Oh, shit, I gotta retry again. Okay. It's not great. You get lightheaded real fast if you gotta do that one a lot. But there are things that are good in it and things that are not. Like, we've already talked about how all of the voices have changed and a lot of them just do not have that same energy, and I miss the old ones. Banjo and Conker completely like acts from the proceedings to be replaced with Dixie Kong and a heavily redesigned Tiny Kong from DK64.
Why is she?
Which I don't, I mean, I, on paper, I don't mind. I think it's really cool to like, yeah, put Dixie Kong in there. And like, I think it's cool to put Tiny Kong and acknowledge DK64, but Tiny's redesign clashes so hard.
Who on the design team needed to go home to their wife that badly?
It is, man, like, just to put it out there, it her redesign, which I think is carried forward in other media, it's a her consistent baby.
Redesign now.
It is a little even more so, look, this is the same franchise that has Candy Kong, and even then it's like, nah, I mean Tiny Kong looks very much, I think, is straight out of like 90s. That is a Britney Spears outfit. Yeah. Complete with the navel and everything.
God, yeah.
Again, nothing wrong with it. It's just
a baby in the in 64. Look at her.
I know, with her big old clown mouth.
Oh, man, it's so strange because I think she's taller than Dixie now, and I feel like Dixie's older. So just
Dixie's
just
literally her older sister, but now Tiny's just that much taller, I guess.
Had a growth spurt, I suppose, and Dixie's just looking up like, oh.
Maybe they're second, you know, they're like second or third cousins removed a few times, actually.
The DK64 manual says sister, so I'm going to, you know, just say that Tiny is now the Luigi to Dixie's Mario in way too many ways.
I know, Luigi has always been sexier than Mario, right?
I mean, I'm not going to dispute that.
What a man.
But yeah, there's nothing, again, there's nothing wrong with this design on its own. It just clashes so bad with the other characters in this game.
It's just so disparate from like everything.
But yeah, I'm glad that, you know, if we had to lose Conker and Banjo, it is cool to see other Kongs.
Yeah. The one thing on the character select that I will give this game credit for is that, yeah, they finally made Taj and Whizpig playable, which I feel like, yeah, no, they should have been playable in the original version, even if they had to scale them down, which is what they did here. The other cool thing I really like about the DS version is that they actually added 4 new tracks to the game, all themed around DK Island.
That is the cool thing. That is, I want to experience those. I might have to keep playing.
Yeah, those are neat. Like, one of the things about this game is that they've gotten rid of the bananas, and instead you're collecting, you know, coins along, like Rareware coins along the track, and you use them to buy. You can buy a bunch of stuff, like the new tracks, the battle tracks, new features, vehicle upgrades, stuff like that. And I actually like the new tracks. I think they're generally pretty good. Thunder Cove is a pretty basic one. Meandering Mount is like kind of a cool mountaintop track that actually like has the it has minecart shafts that you can go through that are a little bit faster, but also have like really tight corridors you got to get through. Splashdown Pass is like a big canyon level where you can like take upper routes that have more boosters, but it's, you know, takes longer to get up the slopes and stuff like that. And then Strangled Shrine is another like all hovercraft track that's just got a really cool like kind of dingy temple aesthetic with maybe my favorite track in the DS version. From the soundtrack.
I do want to give a special mention to, you know, you can customize, what is it? There's billboards and emblems, which I know Mario Kart DS did the emblem thing where, you know, draw the little pixel thing. But this is one of the only other DS games that I know that uses the recording your own voice feature. To replace a few sound effects in the game to where it's like winning a race, losing a race, firing and getting hit by an item. And that is just fascinating to me because the only one I ever had was Star Fox Command, where it would ask you to record like a short sentence and then use your own voice to make up like the animalese babbling sounds that are reminiscent of the original Star Fox. And if I think I still have my original save file. I'll put in a clip right here of my voice in Star Fox if I have it.
I don't know.
Just a weird little feature to use the, you know, the horrifically low quality mic in the DS that was mostly used for, as we've discussed, blowing into.
Yeah.
Oh, but it's there.
It sure is. The other one of the things you can customize as well is you can make custom tracks, sort of.
Sort of.
Like they have a new wish track system where both as basically in the adventure mode. Well, there's two big changes. There's no more silver coin challenges in adventure mode. You can still unlock them just for casual play. But in adventure mode, they are replaced by a balloon touch mini game where you are in first person mode on a magic carpet. Like you go through a single lap and you have to scroll the screen around and tap balloons scattered across the stage. And you get a gold, silver, or bronze medal based on how many you get. You need at least bronze to move on. But like, it's so frustrating to control because you're trying to like, with a touchscreen, you're trying to rotate the camera, touch the balloons, and also drag coins scattered around into your bag to like collect for buying stuff. But it's just really unwieldy and it's a bit much. And I wish that they had done it so you only need to touch the coins and the balloons and you could have rotated the screen with, you know, the control pad or the buttons or something. Because otherwise it's just completely unwieldy and a mess.
Yeah, what if I just don't do that? I don't think I will.
And then in place of the battle modes, you get the TT amulet pieces. By every world has a wish track that's like, okay, we want you to design a track to these specifications. Like the first three, I think they just give you a template to follow, but you can adjust like the verticality. And then the fourth one is like, okay, go nuts, make whatever kind of track you want for this one. And it's cool that they give you some level of, you know, track customization there, but they're all just like very basic flat tracks with no hazards. You know, verticality is basically the only differentiating factor you can kind of change there, and that's about it. But
yeah, I remember watching someone's long play of that and they just made a circle. I'm just like, I just want to get this over with.
It's cool that it's there though. I appreciate them trying to do something there. The DS version is interesting. You know, I wouldn't play it over the N64 version. I would love if, you know, somebody like Diddy Kong Racing hacking still very much in its infancy. There are some people who have like replace some tracks with like maps from GoldenEye because of course, but I'm hoping that someday soon someone cracks adding new tracks and just puts in the Donkey Kong Island tracks, because that would be really cool to have in that version with, you know, not having to blow into my microphone and rub my touchscreen every time I want to get a boost.
Yeah, I can't speak from personal experience, but something in my heart tells me there is somebody out there working their fingers to the bone trying to get a decomp going for Diddy Kong.
The decomp is already in the works. It's still in early stages, but somebody's working on
the DK decomp. Sorry, I'm just imagining how much I struggled on the second Bluey stage. I'm just imagining also having to blow into my microphone while trying to get set up for that one.
Oh man,
it's cool that they did it anyway, just maybe not like that.
Yeah. it's so funny that I remember very much so people talking about how poorly or badly the 3D was used on the 3DS. But then I'm realizing by hindsight that like all the goofy DS gimmicks were probably used worse, because like, yeah, what do you use the microphone for? Oh, scream into it or blow into it or bad voice recognition or and you know, finding people who, and I can't remember, I may have been one of them, I can't say for sure, I don't want to toot my own horn, but getting stuck on a Zelda Phantom Hourglass because I didn't realize you needed to close the system to imprint the map on that one part of the game. Anyway, mostly good memories.
Yeah.
Oh yes, I saw this just the other day. This that Diddy Kong Racing has a anti-piracy measures, and one of them is if it realizes it's been copied to a, you know, an illegal cartridge or whatever, is the whole game flips upside down except for the UI elements. So it's not even like a total flip; it's just all of the gameplay to make it even more disoriented.
Hey, that's Adventure 3.
Also makes it so. Your character, all the characters' heads, like, are constantly spinning around.
Oh my god,
that's funny.
Adventure 4, Exorcist Edition.
But that was the last time we would see Diddy Kong Racing re-released in any capacity. Unfortunately, no virtual console, still no NSO. But this was not the last time that they tried to do more Diddy Kong Racing. There were actually multiple attempts to do more with that world and those characters. Like, we mentioned earlier how Dinosaur Planet was originally going to be a Timber adventure game. But the one I immediately think of that I remember very, very distinctly is Donkey Kong Racing, which was going to be a GameCube game that let you actually ride on animal, like some of the DK animal buddies instead of vehicles. But there was also like a virtual component where you could like raise them and raise their stats to make them more effective in races. And unfortunately, we never got anything beyond like this original trailer from, I want to say, E3 2001, I think. That sounds right in my head.
It wasn't a Space World trailer? Space World wasn't around by 2001, was it?
It might have been Space World. I think it was E3. But
I remember this is one of the legendary, like, saw screenshots of this on very early internet times.
Yeah, I remember being, like, super young and downloading, like, a real media video of this in 144p or whatever having my mind.
Yep. There's that old IGN watermark too.
So I'm just watching the trailer. For some reason, the way the font is laid out, it kind of almost looks like it says Donkey Kong Raging. Just imagining it, that's summoning a whole different image for me.
Well, I mean, he would be raging because the game got canceled because of the buyouts. They did try to keep going by turning it into a Saberman game called Saberman Stampede. And I think it made it as far as the 360 before they finally gave up on it wholesale.
Oh, Taj is there. Yep. That's so sad.
Oh, there's a normal looking Tiny Kong.
and Kitty Kong of all people's in there too.
Oh no. Due to fan demand, I'm sure.
How can one baby be so hateable?
Yeah, no,
that's interesting.
They tried to make it work and it just didn't end up happening. One that sort of ended up happening is Diddy Kong Pilot, which was a GBA game announced at the same E3, which was, that one kind of went through a weird journey where it was originally, you know, it started out as kind of like a very simple, like a Mario Kart, except you could move the planes vertically, you know, kind of like Super Circuit, but go up and down. That went through a bunch of different things. Like, there was even a phase, like, you know, I showed you that early screenshot of some of the characters, you know, Cranky, DK, Diddy, Crunch, K. Rool, Dixie, Bumpkin Kong. but this went through a couple different revisions, one of which actually had Mario characters in it too.
Oh.
What?
Yeah, no, there is at least one prototype that did get out that had, like, assets of, you know, Mario and Peach and Yoshi and Bowser and Toad, and like, yeah, no, they were looking to combine them all at one point, which is really wild to think about. But again, the buyout happened, and after a brief fling with trying to actually do voxel-based 3D, which, again, that prototype got out there, and it's wild that they got that working, they basically replaced all of the Donkey Kong stuff with Banjo stuff, and it became Banjo Pilot, except a lot of the music is still very Donkey Kong inspired, and like most of the assets are the same, except they occasionally put in like a banjo thing over something else, like changing DK's Treehouse to Spiral Mountain or whatever. But like, It seems like the Banjo switchover was pretty rushed in 11th hour, because if you listen to the first stage of Banjo Pilot, it sounds like a just close enough version of the Donkey Kong theme.
I remember when this came out, and it was another one that, God, I mean, at least Game Boy Advance, I knew I did not have my own disposable income, so it was like, well, I need to be picky and choosy for Christmas and birthdays, and I was like, well, I like Banjo, but I don't know about this racing game. I think I'd rather get, you know, Super Mario World ported there instead.
Yeah, no, I liked the actual Banjo Adventure game, Grumpy's Revenge, but Pilot was one where it's like, I don't really need this, and I didn't buy it until years later when it was cheap.
Okay, yeah, this is a legally distinct Jungle Hijinks.
Yeah, yes, very much so. And yeah, I remember I never got the Mario Kart, Mario Kart Super Circuit, which is a pretty good Mario Kart game, but I didn't know anybody to hook up my GBA with to play multiplayer with. So anything that was multiplayer focused on the GBA was an automatic, like, I don't know about that as a kid.
Same here.
Like, don't get me wrong, Banjo Pilot's got some cool ideas. Like, it's got some cool, like, dogfight boss battles and a bunch of, like, different modes, like, similar to the Silver Coin Challenge, but way, like, less annoying. Like, I think that it's, like, you have to get four pieces of a Jiggy instead of silver coins, but they're all, like, a lot more reasonably laid out. So, and then it's got other, you know, time trial stuff, side modes, that sort of thing. Like, it would have been interesting to see it stick with the DK license and, you know, keep the DK and maybe the Mario characters. But, you know, for what it is, Banjo Pilot's totally fine.
It seems like it's definitely a spiritual successor in a loose sense. But yeah, I might have to check it out.
Yeah, it's worth at least taking a look at. One other attempt made by not Rare, but Climax Studios was Diddy Kong Racing Adventure, which was going to be a GameCube game they had pitched where, basically while Diddy is off saving Timber's Island from Wizpig, the Kremlings use his absence to kidnap the other Kongs, take over DK Island and start like bulldozing it to turn it into a big raceway. And eventually Wizpig teams up with them and Diddy has to stop them all. It was going to have a big adventure mode like the original. It would have had planes, jet skis, quad bikes, buggies, and hover scooters. And there would have been like most of the roster would have returned. They wanted to get back, you know, Banjo and Conker, would have swapped them out if unavailable. Dixie and Lanky were also considered on top of that. They wanted to add DK. They would have had dark versions of all the racers that you would have boss battles against, like Dark Pepsi and Dark Bumper. Who knows what kind of crimes Dark Bumper would have committed?
I was about to say,
I see no hear no evil.
Their blood is on the wall.
But yeah, no, they pitched this to Nintendo, got shot down, but a couple of years ago, a prototype running on Xbox hardware got out and is totally playable.
Wow.
So that's wild to think about.
Goodness gracious. it's one of those that, like, hindsight, 2020, all that butterfly effect, but I sure do wish somebody could pop in a time machine and just talk Nintendo into buying out Rare instead, because...
If nothing else, even if Rare wasn't using them, those IPs would probably have gotten a lot more use than they did under the Xbox family.
Yeah, exactly. It's hard to say like where Microsoft is and not get into too many like things that are happening right now. But yeah, man, I don't think we're ever going to get a Banjo sequel or anything, man. Not even like a cameo follow-up.
I think Banjo could still get a sequel, but it's not going to come from Rare. Like, they've made it clear that they want to keep working on original stuff. So
it's just kind of sad to me that Rare on the Nintendo 64 producing so many bangers, banger after banger after banger, and pretty much almost immediately after, things really petered out for Rare, I think. Maybe I'm wrong, maybe there's like lots of Rare fans out there saying like, no, don't you remember this GameCube title that was really great? Like, maybe there were some.
There was only the one.
I don't know, man. Every, like, all of Rare's success was localized to this time, including Diddy Kong Racing, which is great.
They did make one last attempt to do a Diddy Kong Racing spiritual sequel, which went through a couple different names. Originally, it was a Banjo-exclusive kart racer called Banjo-Kazooie.
I've heard of that
which
one.
Which is a really good pun. Originally, it was Banjo-Karting. Then it became Banjo-Kazooie. There's been some concept art floating around from that era. Then it finally settled on The Fast and the Furriest, which actually had a whole featurette in Rare Replay showing what this game was going to be.
Oh, cool.
It would have been a crossover racer featuring a bunch of different Rare characters. So, like, Banjo was in there, Saberman, Saberwolf from KI, Vela from Jet Force Gemini, Rash, Joanna Dark. But the thing about that game was that it would have had the ability to, like, use the, like, magic wrench from Nuts and Bolts to affect the, like, build stuff on the track to create shortcuts and also steal parts from other racers' vehicles to put on yours and augment yourself, which sounds like it would have been a wild, like, concept to get into. And unfortunately, again, that one didn't end up happening. But one major thing did come out of it is that one of the vehicles they designed for that game ended up getting carried over into a little game you might know called Sonic and Sega All-Stars Racing.
Oh.
There you go, Sonic fans. You were waiting for this to be relevant to your interests. So finally.
Yeah, no, when Banjo got added into that game, the vehicle was designed by Rare and was just taken from this kart racing game that never got made for 360. So it lives on in that one very strange, obscure way.
I mean, there were some really strange cameos in the All-Star Racing games. Do you remember the Team Fortress guys were in it?
Sequel alongside Danica Patrick, Wreck-It Ralph, and that one guy from Yogscast.
What's going on back then?
I'll forgive the Yogscast one because that was for charity, but only just barely. But yeah, no, there would not be any, like, proper follow-up to Diddy Kong Racing, although there were, it's been referenced here and there in some very strange ways. Like, you know, the every once in a while when Banjo shows up, they will, like, straight up mention the fact that was his first game. The Mario Artist Paint Studio for Nintendo 64 DD had a bunch of the DKR official art as, like, stamps you could put on your artwork. Arguably the most interesting one, I think, is, remember our old pal Greenwood Village?
Yeah.
So Diddy Kong Racing was not its last appearance, because if you, I believe, beat the, like, little racing mode in Jet Force Gemini, you could totally unlock it as a secret track in that game. And it is still there in the Rare Replay version.
Oh, wow.
Interesting. Wow. It's cool that they brought back those horrible memories.
Yeah, no, it's totally there. The shortcut in the well has been covered up, so you can't go down anymore. But yeah, no, you can totally unlock it. And I think that carried over because JFG was built on the DKR engine. And so as a result, when they started building Mickey Speedway USA, they used that same engine, and both Greenwood Village and the Mizar racetrack from JFG are, like, hidden away in the code of that game as well. So somehow Greenwood Village has become the most notable track in all of Diddy Kong Racing.
Well, it sure is memorable, that's for sure.
It certainly is.
Oh, boy.
In terms of, you know, other ways that it got carried over, it technically showed up in not one but two different manga series. Like, there was Mario no Bulkenland, which was, like, a weird, like, half manga, half, like, kids playbook thing that had a chapter dedicated to Diddy Kong Racing alongside a bunch of other, like, Nintendo 64 games. But there was also a volume based on Diddy Kong Racing in the 4-Koma Gagland, I believe it's called, manga anthology, which was, or 4-Koma Gag Battle, excuse me, which was like a weird, you know, like a four coma comedy series with, you know, four panel comics that it was basically all just different little gag strips in this one little volume dedicated to Diddy Kong Racing, where other games got their own volumes as well. And I can't even read half of these, but there are some choice ones in here.
Sorry, I'm looking through them now. They're very cute. The first one, that picture of Bumpo, is adorable for a criminal. he knows what he did.
He absolutely wow. knows what he did, and he has zero remorse.
Oh wow, these are surreal to look at. That they work really well in these, like, this cute little manga yeah. style.
I love how expressive they are.
Yeah, I found my two favorites. Everybody's favorite foods, and then Diddy taking second place into his own hands.
Oh, that's really
good.
Oh
wow, that's very good.
Yep.
Using Tip-Top as a green shell.
I love that.
As you would.
I mean, four panel funnies just transcend language. Like,
yeah. It is weird seeing Conker with nuts when we all know his actual preferred food is beer.
Beer and poop.
Yeah. See, I was going to reference anti-gravity chocolate, but there's no coming back from that.
I was going to say, the other one I really like is clearly written before Banjo-Kazooie came out. It's the Timber and Diddy wondering what's in Banjo's backpack. Arguably, the most interesting thing to come out of this is the revelation that, yeah, no, Rare still owns all of the Diddy Kong Racing original characters, and they are now branded as
right.
Rare Racers, and you can buy merch of them at Fangamer.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
I've seen that. I've seen like little Timber and the little Whizbeak, yeah. little Banjo. Oh, wow. Look at these. Oh, innocent looking Conker. Although, no, he is wearing his hoodie.
Yeah, that's
though,
the bad
so
fur
that's interesting.
Hoodie.
Yeah. Well, he looks innocent. Yeah. I suppose technically Conker still did, even during those times. Oh, man. Diddy Kong Racing was a big deal for 5 minutes.
I know.
I think it still holds up spectacularly well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd agree.
It does. You just can't play it legally unless you've got like the original console.
Well, your lips to Nintendo's ears. I'm hoping that, you know, all the Rare games we've been getting on NSO mean that is, you know, not far behind. Like,
I know,
we've got Banjo-Kazooie, Jet Force Gemini, and GoldenEye. So I got to think that Diddy Kong Racing will come further down the line.
I know the GoldenEye re-releases have been not good, but the fact that they happened at all makes me think that Diddy Kong Racing, Banjo-Tooie are in the hopper. They're just sitting on them right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, those two and DK64 have got to be, like, you know, on the way, I gotta think.
I mean, DK64 was on the virtual console.
Yeah,
right?
the Wii U.
That's possible.
And to its credit, DKR still has like a very active competitive scene, like, you know, tracking times and, you know, online multiplayer through different methods and whatnot. Like, people still really love this game. So it's a testament to its quality, I think.
I think this is a game that a new generation should get to play.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Like, maybe it doesn't quite live up to the general racing standards of like later kart racing games, but there's so much charm here.
Yes.
There's so much character. There's so much stuff that hasn't really been touched by a majority of kart racing games or any sort of games, really. Feels kind of like its own thing that just sort of happened and then just almost got completely abandoned, apart from these little like nods to it in the past.
I would love if we'd get either a re-release or if somebody would try something new in that same vein with like the adventure focused kart racer thing. Like, you know, getting to play the Crash Team Racing remake kind of wet that itch a couple of years ago, but, you know, there's nothing quite like DKR.
It really was like a little Saturday morning cartoon you could play. It was a Saturday morning racing cartoon, like a Wacky Races, but with like little animal characters and it was a game that had like little voices in it, and you know, all the characters had like personality, and it had that lovely David Wise soundtrack, which we haven't talked about too much.
Yeah.
But, oh,
Yeah, like I think they even knew that like it was going for that Saturday morning vibe. If you've ever seen the Japanese commercial for it.
Oh my God, let's take a look at this. Oh, Bumper's right there. Look at him.
It's very reminiscent of that one Mario Kart animated commercial as well.
I mean, you're just thinking of that Mario, that intense as fuck looking Mario and like, drifting in his cart. Oh, that's so good. Oh, Conker's so cute there. Really was the before times.
Before the troubles.
Yeah. But all those characters just perfectly map onto that cartoon animation. It's like, man, I want like a silly Banjo-Kazooie Saturday morning cartoon. Come on.
Me too. Basically the end of our discussion, but I felt like we needed a whole section just to discuss the soundtrack for a couple of reasons. One, because it's incredible. Some of David Wise's best work, in my opinion.
I also agree.
Yeah.
But also, this is one of the divergence points for the DS remake, because if you'll remember, there were a couple of tracks in the original that shared music. So like, you know, Pirate Lagoon and Treasure Caves shared a track, Everfrost Peak and Snowball Valley shared a track, stuff like that. But in the DS version, in addition to porting everything over to that instrument set, they actually wanted to give everybody, like every track, its own bespoke music. So if you guys are up for it, what would you say to a very short impromptu listening party?
Let's do it.
Sure.
Everyone, every Sonic fan who's still listening to this, thanks for sticking with us so far. Now we're getting to music. Yeah,
we got our handful of mentions of Sonic in already. This is for us.
Yep.
Yeah, fair enough.
So the first one that changed was Jungle Falls, which I'm sure we all remember. Again, I think this is probably one of my favorite tracks in the whole soundtrack. But for the DS remake, they actually turned that into the credits theme and gave Jungle Falls a whole new track, which I'm going to jump to here.
Hmm.
Oh, yeah, that's...
Well, I'm here in the jungle.
Yeah, it's
that's
very
interesting, because this, I mean, this has more... I'm sorry, Jake, you were about to say Donkey Kong Country feel.
Yep, I was about to say very reminiscent. Yep.
It's interesting because it's one of those where I don't want to immediately go, different bad, but no, that's not bad at all.
I can dig it.
Yeah, the DS remake uses a lot of vocal samples in its soundtrack, which is it's different.
It's not unprecedented though, because stuff like Hop Top Volcano also had like some vocal samples in the background, mm-hmm. So it fits. Yeah.
So jumping forward a bit to Pirate Lagoon.
Oh yeah, God, this is another one to. That little hook just in my head forever.
So, unfortunately, this is the one song that got cut out of the DS version completely.
Oh!
I couldn't tell you why. Like, I don't know if there was, like, meant to go somewhere else or what, but, like, for whatever reason, it is just not in that version at all.
I don't know if it's going to be one of those ones where maybe it was like pulling from an existing song a bit too much or not. I couldn't tell you which one because I don't know if it is. But David Wise does have a habit of like rather skillfully like replicating existing songs. I mean, listen to TT's theme when you select him.
There's a lot of Christmas music actually like taken wholesale in, I think, either Frosty Village or Walrus Cove.
I mean, yeah.
But Pirate Lagoon and Treasure Caves both got entirely new tracks, so here's new Pirate Lagoon.
A little predictable with those fake steel drums.
This sounds more like a lost Mario Kart track to me, I think.
Yeah, uh-huh. I can't remember. Did I miss? Do we know who did this new music?
It's also David Wise.
Probably okay. Using a different okay. Like.
Oh, well, that's interesting.
He's probably composing it differently, I imagine. It had been a while since he composed the soundtrack for the original game.
Yeah, it's been almost 10 years.
Like they're definitely, like, I'm not playing the DS versions of existing tracks because it's like, it's just the same, it's just a different, same track, different instrument set, and arguably sounds a little bit worse on DS. So, but I wanted to play like the ones that are completely new, like the new Treasure Caves. It sounds like Palm Tree Panic to me, U.S.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, I mean, those vocal samples in the jungle, I was immediately like, oh, the ladies from Sonic CD are back.
This is all, like, good music. I just don't know if it's quite as bombastic enough as what I would expect from Diddy Kong Racing.
Yeah,
that is also what I would say.
Okay, that's nice.
That's cute.
I'm enjoying these vocal samples.
Like I said, a lot of vocal samples in this one. It's definitely a different vibe from the original.
Mm-hmm. God, it just makes me wonder, like, what was the logic in some of these?
Well, I mean, aside from this batch, like, the rest of the tracks are all still around. It's just that they wanted to give every track its own, its own bespoke music instead of having to share between them. Mm-hmm. Which I can appreciate that. So jumping forward to Everfrost Peak and Snowball Valley. Yep, and this did stick around on DS Everfrost Peak.
Also, okay, this bit right here, how it ends, to me, sounds like the Brady Bunch theme.
Oh, yeah.
Am I crazy? Yeah,
no, I hear it.
The Brady Bunch.
I 100% hear it.
Okay, thank you. My 9-year-old self is justified for watching Nick at Night all the time.
It makes me think of just like a German or Polish, like, polka thing with an accordion.
Uh-huh.
It does have a very kind of polka sound to it.
And it almost sounds like a Weird Al polka compilation.
Ja, it is called You Are the Racing.
All right, jumping forward to the new Snowball Valley.
Oh, wow. This is very much sounds like a DS Mario game. Put some wah-wahs in there, and it's new Super Mario Brothers.
Wah, wah. I can hear it.
This sounds like, you know, an afternoon stroll in France in a DS game.
Yeah, it does. Or like a jog, just because of the pace of it. I like it. I like this.
I think it... Mm-hmm. I like it, but I feel like it's a bit too slow, like, low energy for Snowball Valley, where you're trying to avoid giant snowballs coming at you.
Yeah. I prefer the polka.
And of course, jumping forward to our favorite track, Greenwood Village / Windmill Plains.
I mean, this is a good song. Like, it really is.
Yeah.
It's just hard to hear over the sound of me screaming in frustration.
Yeah, it is the theme of suffering in this game.
This is definitely one of the ones that always stuck with me, like, years and years on. Like, I think it's just a really good sound, track. Not to be confused with being a really good track. That's an entirely different track. Yeah, this is still Greenwood Village in the DS version, but Windmill Plains got its own song with...
And coming to you from our alternative rock station.
Yeah. This does sound like some dad rock.
Like, if there was an old West track, I feel like this is where this should go.
Oh, yeah, now I hear it, yep.
Oh, you know, for that cowboy world that we didn't get in Sonic Prime.
Yeah.
maybe it's like that because of all the hay bales, like, scattered around the sides.
Yeah.
Which, unlike the one in Conker, do not, you know, turn out to be a big Terminator cyborg. So let's take a look at the Star City Space Dust Alley track.
Maybe it's because I was just playing this before we started, finishing up that last stage, but a lot of this is stuck in my head. And also, like you said earlier, Falero, TT's voice going, Star City.
Yeah. I like the overall vibe. I think it's real good. This is an interesting case, though, because it got, like, this is still on Star City, but Space Dust Alley did not get a new track because the Spaceport Alpha music got moved to Space Dust Alley. And Spaceport Alpha got a new track instead, which I'm going to play for you right here.
Which I don't think is, it's interesting. I don't think that's blasphemous just because of how these carts are set up. Because, you know, you would say that, like, you wouldn't swap Mario Kart track music around. But because all of the tracks are themed to their hub worlds, it feels a little like, oh, yeah, you can just kind of shift things around and get the tone right.
I like this. Yeah, like immediately I started bobbing my head to it.
Domo arigato, Mr. Roboto.
Yeah, I was meant to say it evokes a certain feeling.
I like that synth.
Yeah, I could feel like I feel like I could hear this in like maybe a Mega Man Battle Network or something.
Yeah.
I
personally dig this one. I think it's pretty good.
I like it.
Mm-hmm.
And then to just get through some of the other tracks that were not replacements, this is that one changed music track that Chris was alluding to earlier.
Yep. Sea shanty pirate ass music.
Yeah, I was about to say, what a jovial jig.
Probably going a bit Gangplank Galleon with this. You know, David Wise.
Yeah, no, this has definitely got some Gangplank Galleon energy to it. Like, I would not be surprised if this was meant to be the original Pirate Lagoon or Treasure Cage or something. But now we're going to get real quickly into the music tracks from the new DK Island racetrack. So we're going to start with Thunder Cove.
Before it even gets into it.
You already
sure
know.
It's Donkey Kong, yeah. Now, is it going to have that hook? You're waiting.
Oh, you know it is.
Oh, it's coming. It's coming. I can tell.
Nope. That's teasing. It's teasing.
Let's be real. This track was the one big absence from DKR.
Yeah. The crowd goes wild as the beat drops.
I love me some Jungle Hijinks.
Yes.
It is funny that there is a slight reference to it in Diddy's select theme. If you're on the selection screen, it's playing like, you know, the Diddy Kong Racing theme. But this is, you know, the way the notes go around sounds a little bit like Jungle Hijinks. So.
I wish that we had gotten a like full Jungle Hijinks in Diddy Kong Racing somewhere, because it's like, it is such a intrinsic part of the Donkey Kong series, like, whole identity at this point. It feels like something is missing without it. And I'm glad that the DS version got not just one, but two versions of it.
Of course.
Thanks to Meandering Mount.
Dispensing with any pretense in this one.
Yep. Like, the one thing that I will say I really do not like about the DS version soundtrack is that it doesn't have any of the dynamic music. It just shifts at predetermined points, so a lot of, like, the overworld and Boulder Canyon stuff just kind of, the music really gets neutered as a result and sounds not great, but I do really like these original tracks a lot. And I think this one really works for the difference in Meandering Mount, where you're, like, going through a lot of tunnels and minecart segments and stuff. Like, it's a different vibe. But then to move on to Splashdown Pass, which will sound a little familiar in a different way. It, yeah, they just had to stick in the main theme one more spot, I guess.
Yeah, the main Diddy Kong Racing theme.
Yeah.
But Donkey Kong.
Yeah. Just jungly.
I don't know why I was thinking DK64 for a second.
It's the instrumentation, yeah. I would say.
Yeah. But I think my favorite of the new tracks is almost certainly Strength of Shrine, just because it is so different.
Sonic's back.
Yeah, and it fits like the Dingy Temple stage perfectly. Like, it definitely evokes like the temple music from some of the old Donkey Kong Country levels.
It definitely reminds me in the style a little bit of, I think, the track David Wise is probably most famous for, which is the swimming levels in Donkey Kong
Country. Yeah, yeah, aquatic ambience.
Yeah, the tempo is much more up there, but like, yeah, the fact that you say they're both composed by the same guy.
It's just got a really cool vibe to it. And I have heard, like, people convert all of these tracks to use the N64 instruments, and they sound real good.
Oh, cool.
Nice.
Ooh.
As they should.
To look that up.
Definitely go look those up for yourselves, because they're really good, and I, like, highly encourage more of that sort of thing. But, that basically brings our Diddy Kong Racing discussion to an end.
Yeah, one thing I want to mention about the music is, upon, like, really playing it in preparation for this episode, some of the musical tracks that played, especially the main hub world music, it was so cool to hear it, because I was just like, oh, that's where this is from. Because, like, I'll hear it from, like, random YouTubers who just use it for background music. And and I didn't realize just how much good music is in this game. And it's so cool to, like, have that almost like fireworks moment in your mind of just like, oh, that's cool. That's where this from.
What a soundtrack. What a game.
Yes.
I feel very nice to have finally completed it in some form. And I might just keep playing it.
I mean, there are worse games to spend your time with.
I'm looking into how to host a lobby in RetroArch so that we could all possibly play together.
Ooh.
We will definitely have to do that sometime. Yes. I would be 100% down for that. But I guess that more or less brings us to the end of our discussion. So once again, we implore whoever is listening, please get Diddy Kong Racing on Nintendo Switch Online. It's just, it's right there. Come on.
Listen, you like talking animal characters and colorful, funny situations like Sonic fans should, then you're probably going to enjoy this, because it was like a little Saturday morning cartoon you could play, and that's just the sort of thing I would loved, you know. It's so fun, so charming, so colorful, so joyful.
The closest any racing game I feel has ever come to recreating the Diddy Kong Racing experience are, you know, Crash Team Racing and then Sonic and All-Stars Racing Transform. Those are the closest I think anybody's... Sonic maybe probably even closer, just because of like the different vehicle types and everything. But I would love somebody to develop like a true spiritual successor with, you know, the multiple vehicles, the adventure mode. Like, nobody has managed to basically bring all of the elements together all at once. And I would love to see somebody try and tackle that someday. But until that happens, whenever it happens, you can find me on all the socials at Cyberlink420.
You can find me across various socials on the internet as Game Buddy, sometimes with a 123, but you'll probably be able to tell which one is me.
You can find me all across the internet at FAULERRO. I'm Falero, if I said that in the wrong way. Oh, well. I really f***ed it up this time.
I love
time.
That jingle. Yeah.
Still love the jingle, no matter where it comes from. And you can find me on the socials as Rock the Jake. And hey, I'm finally starting to get into streaming a little bit more. So you can find me on Twitch as Mr. Rock the Jake.
And now you've got another game to potentially stream.
This is true, especially if I get that hosting thing going.
And special thanks, as always, to Amy Waters for the use of our theme song. And you can check out more of her work on YouTube and Bandcamp. And remember to subscribe, review, share, all that good stuff so that we can get more ears on this podcast. Yeah. Because we have a lot of fun doing it, even when we're doing something, arguably especially when we're doing something completely different.
Yeah, if you want more Diddy Kong Racing episodes, well, you probably won't do it again. But well, maybe if they bring out Diddy Kong Racing 2. Oh,
be still in my beating heart. So on the next episode of The Wood Village Is Always Greener, we're going to be talking about Mickey Speedway USA, the closest thing we got to a direct sequel.
Right.
In a weird way.
In a roundabout kind of way.
In a roundabout kind of way. Like, there's, like, if you thought Greenwood Village was hard, oh my God, some of the tracks in that game are devilish. Like, I will never go to Colorado because I have bad memories playing the track from this game. And I just assume that everybody from Colorado is a bad person for having to live there. I stand by that statement. But until then, I'm Cyberlink.
I'm Game Buddy.
Oh, yeah. I'm Falero.
And I'm Rock the Jake. And wait. What's going on? I feel a rumbling.
He's T-posing.
I'm not a worm.
This has been The Wood Village Is Always Greener. We'll see you on the other side, maybe.
Skurdoink, burdoink, skurgiddly widdly wink, a flunky doinky doinky punky doo, scrambliddly blue, ba da ga da ga doo, ba ba da ma da ma, we're gonna die.